The next item of business is the second stage of the Licensing and Registration of Clubs Amendment Bill. I call the Minister for Communities to move the second stage of the Licensing and Registration of Clubs Amendment Bill and open the debate on the bill. Minister.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I beg to move that the second stage of the Licensing and Registration of Clubs Amendment Bill be agreed. In July 2014, one of my predecessors, Nelson McCausland, published proposals for the way forward in relation to changes to the law regulating the sale and supply of alcohol in Northern Ireland. Measures in this bill are broadly in line with those proposals, which are aimed at tackling ongoing political and community concerns surrounding the excessive and harmful consumption of alcoholic drinks. The bill will also provide some assistance to the hospitality sector to support the tourism offering here. The bill contains 27 clauses, which are divided into provisions affecting licensed premises, pubs, restaurants, hotels and the like, which will amend the Licensing Northern Ireland Order 1996, and those affecting registered clubs, which will amend the Registration of Clubs Northern Ireland Order 1996. As many of the provisions affect both licensed premises and registered clubs, I will provide an overview of those first. The period of drinking up time at the end of a premises and registered club's permitted hours will be extended by 30 minutes to 1 hour for a trial period of 1 year. This will discourage customers from stockpiling drinks during last orders and drinking too quickly, and will allow for a more gradual dispersal of people onto the streets, allowing staff more time to clear the premises in an orderly fashion. This will reduce the impact on local communities at closing time, and in particular allowing people to remain inside while waiting on a taxi. The removal of alcohol in sealed containers will also be prohibited. This will reduce impulse buys at the end of the night, which often leads to prolonged drinking either at home or, worse, on the streets. Young people will be allowed to attend functions in certain licensed premises and registered clubs, provided a number of conditions are met. This will ensure that young people have a safe environment to hold events, such as formals, where adequate safeguards are in place and no opportunity exists for young people to obtain alcoholic drinks. The sale and supply of alcohol by self-service and vending machines will be prohibited. This will ensure that the sale of alcoholic drinks is always supervised, allowing trained staff in a regulated environment the opportunity to monitor alcohol consumption and refuse the sale of alcoholic drinks when necessary. The Department will be able to approve a code of practice, provided it is produced by a person or group of persons who have a relevant interest in matters surrounding intoxicating liquor. Courts must then be satisfied, depending on whether a licence is being granted or renewed, that the licence holder is aware of their responsibilities under the code and has been complying with those responsibilities. A voluntary code of practice currently operates. This code was launched in 2012 and outlines the basic standards involved in the promotion, retail and service of alcohol. It applies to on and off trade and looks to promote best practice and to prevent alcoholic drinks being promoted or sold in an irresponsible fashion. This amendment will allow the Department to approve a code of practice with legal consequences for non-compliance. Licensed premises and registered clubs will no longer be required to obtain a children's certificate. However, they will have to comply with a number of conditions if children are to be permitted on the premises. All current protections for children will remain in place. Children's certificates date back to a time when some licensed premises and registered clubs did not have adequate facilities for children, such as toilet facilities or seating and dining areas. The diversification in licensed premises in recent years has resulted in higher quality facilities, and I consider the time is right to ease the burden on business by removing the requirement to go to court to obtain one of these certificates. Later opening hours for the Thursday before Good Friday, which previously allowed certain premises and registered clubs to stay open to midnight, now mirrors the later opening available for any other weekday in the year, up to 1 a.m. the following day. Mr. Speaker, Easter is a period of special significance in Northern Ireland, which is reflected in licensing law, and I'm not prepared to remove the current restrictions entirely. Moving on to the provisions which affect licensed premises only, liquor licences and entertainment licences will be aligned so that entertainment or refreshment provided during additional permitted hours is not allowed to continue after the end of drinking up time. This will make it easier for the police to ensure all premises are complying with the law. Premises which are already permitted additional hours until 1 a.m. will be permitted to apply for an additional 1 hour. The additional hour can be granted for a maximum of 12 days in the year. This will allow certain premises to open later on nights such as New Year's Eve and on other special occasions. I'm not prepared to move to a general 2 a.m. closing. The law in respect of children will be strengthened to ensure that young people can no longer accept delivery of intoxicating liquor at the home address of the purchaser. Delivery drivers will be required to record in a logbook occasions they requested identification and to detail the form of identification provided. Licensed restaurants will be required to display a notice detailing the conditions under which the alcohol may be sold on the premises. This will provide clarity in restaurants by openly showing the conditions they are bound by. This will address the growing concerns in relation to licensed restaurants, which are operating more like pubs but without the associated overheads of a pub. Off-sale premises, including supermarkets, will only be permitted to advertise alcoholic drinks in the area that they are permitted to display them within their premises. This is intended to reduce the instances of impulse buys of alcoholic drinks, particularly in supermarkets. They will also be prohibited from advertising alcohol promotions within 200 metres of their premises. Angostura bitters will no longer be exempt from the definition of intoxicating liquor and as such may only be sold in licensed premises. This brings duty and licensing regimes into line following the repeal of the excise duty exemption that previously applied to Angostura bitters. And finally, the provisions of the bill which apply only to registered clubs. A sporting club will be able to apply on 6 occasions per year to extend the area of its premises licensed to supply alcohol, provided certain conditions are met. This will allow sporting clubs to take advantage of events at their clubs, such as Captain's Day, which attracts large numbers of members and guests by extending the area where they can supply alcohol to club grounds. Young people will be allowed to remain in the bar area of a registered club until 11 p.m. during the summer months beginning 1st of June to the 31st of August, or to attend an award ceremony on one occasion in a calendar year. This will allow young people to avail of the full range of sporting activities open to them during the summer months, which often extend into the evening. The award ceremony allows sporting clubs to celebrate the success of young people who participate in the sporting activities offered by a club. A registered club will be allowed to advertise any function outside a club premises where the advertisement clearly states that only members of the club and their guests may attend. Currently, members of the general public are permitted to attend functions where the proceeds are devoted to charitable or benevolent purposes. However, the law prohibits a registered club from publicly advertising the function. This provision will ensure there are no restrictions on the advertising of such events. Some of the measures in the bill will, I hope, contribute to a reduction in alcohol-related harm by encouraging those who choose to drink to do so sensibly. I believe that the bill does strike the right balance between controlling the sale of alcoholic drinks on the one hand and offering some support to the hospitality sector on the other. It's clear from the consultation responses and from discussion with stakeholders and indeed other parties that there is significant support for these proposals. And on that basis, I hope that all parties will give the bill their support and allow it to move to consideration stage by the committee. I beg to move.
Call Mrs. Michelle Gildenew, the Deputy Chair of the Communities Committee.
Gormayogav, Ken Corla. I suppose many of us and many more people outside of this House have been waiting in anticipation for a long number of years for a bill to address licensing reform. It's been a bit like waiting for Godot, but with less expectation that the bill would actually arrive first. However, it has arrived, so the Minister deserves credit at least for that. This second stage, as members will know, is not about discussing the details of the bill, rather it's about the principles of the bill. On that basis, they're relatively straightforward and easy to agree on. They relate to bringing forward measures that seek to address excessive alcohol consumption and to support the hospitality sector. The committee supports this principle. However, during the committee stage, we will seek to establish whether the bill strikes the appropriate balance between these apparently competing objectives. Clearly, industry sources already feel that those aspects of the bill which seek to liberalise our licensing laws don't go far enough. Others who may be concerned with the negative impact of alcohol on health and society in general might feel that they go too far. We do, of course, have a responsibility to ensure that the legislation doesn't provide the framework for harm to be visited on society, but neither do we want to be accused of presiding over a nanny state. It will be the job of the committee to consider these arguments and, on the evidence presented, advise this House accordingly. All of us, of course, will have personal views about alcohol based on experience or perhaps even moral or religious beliefs. It's my opinion, and I hope others share it, that while those personal views should inform our consideration of the bill, they shouldn't direct it. We are here to legislate for all of society, not just a narrow section of it which may share our particular beliefs. The committee would acknowledge that it's not easy to strike the right balance between proposals to assist our hospitality industry and the public health concerns about the impact of alcohol. A mature, informed discussion, therefore, is called for, particularly given that the public consultation on this bill took place 4 years ago. So, if public health concerns are to be addressed, it's important to consider drinking patterns and where people are consuming alcohol. This is important so that we don't end up taking action through this bill that neither addresses the negative aspects of alcohol consumption nor supports the hospitality industry. In effect, given the perception of real reform on both key issues, when nothing of actual substance has been achieved on either. That is why reference to evidence is so important. For example, in regard to addressing excessive alcohol consumption, the DHSSPS report, Adult Drinking Patterns in NI 2013, asked people where they consumed alcohol. Around two-thirds of respondents that drank said they did so in their own home, 56% of people, 65% of people rather, while around a fifth drank in the pub, 20%, 17% in a restaurant and 16% in someone else's home. So over 80% of people drank in either their own home or someone else's home. It's also been clear for at least a decade that the number of people drinking in pubs has been falling. In fact, the same report notes that there's been about a 40% reduction in the number of males drinking in pubs between 1999 and 2013, and a reduction of almost 50% of females drinking in pubs during the same period. So the industry is now in a position where only 26% of men and 12% of women who drink do so in pubs. The figures on drinking at home also go some way to explaining the increase in solitary drinking, from 17% in 1999 to 22% in 2013. One can only guess the potential mental health issues that may contribute to. However, the question the committee will have to ask about the bill is this: is the bill doing enough to address excessive drinking where most drinking actually takes place, i.e. in the home? Indeed, we will need to consider whether this bill is even the proper legislative vehicle to do anything about that. So on the basis of where people who drink say they consume alcohol, we should at least recognise that the greater problem is more likely to be as a result of home drinking and drinking alone, not necessarily as a result of drinking in the local pub. As a resident in and representative of a rural constituency, the local pub is often the centre of social gatherings and used for meetings of local community groups. It often has a significance to the community that perhaps an urban pub doesn't have, because there doesn't tend to be any other option in rural areas if the local pub closes. And these pubs are under severe pressure. In fact, a report carried out this year by the insolvency practitioner Begbie's Trainer has revealed that one in four pubs here in the north were operating under significant financial distress and struggling to remain open. There are roughly 2,000 licence holders here. On that calculation, 500 of them are struggling to remain open. Even taking just 3 employees per licence holder, that's not unreasonable, that's 1,000 500 jobs at risk. In February of this year, Bombardier announced that 1,000 jobs were to go, and there was absolute uproar. Ministerial statements and calls for action were flying right, left and centre. And this was for a company, according to then Minister Bale, that received $75 million of executive assistance between 2002 and 2015. So if 1,500 jobs are at risk in the hospitality sector, should we not be making as big a hue and cry as was made in February? Should we not seek to ensure that this sector has the best operating environment in which to survive, and not a penny of executive financial assistance has been called for? We need to see what's achievable and necessary to support the industry, and I'm sure with appropriate counsel we can do that without contributing to the already significant burdens on the health sector or contribute to the moral degradation of our society, as some might suggest. Of course, pictures on the TV of antisocial behaviour in town centres as a result of excessive alcohol consumption fan the flames of negative stereotypes associated with alcohol. However, I'd suggest that the vast majority of people who drink alcohol do so responsibly. Shouldn't we seek to facilitate the good behaviour as well as address the bad? Following that logic, we therefore need to consider whether we are doing enough via this bill to support the hospitality industry. By limiting those proposals in the bill, which in general may be seen as liberalising our current laws, are we in fact inadvertently penalising the hospitality industry because of an erroneous perception of where the alcohol problem actually lies? The committee has been advised by officials that the measures proposed in the bill are modest. Modesty is often said to be a virtue. In the context of this bill, it might be considered a vastly overrated virtue, Cam Corla. One that's a poor substitute for creative thinking and ambitious proposals for the modernisation of licensing laws and therefore the hospitality industry. And I also need to point out the importance of the pub industry in terms of our tourism sector as well, and I'm sure members will allude to that in their contributions today. If we have a vision of what we want our society to become, and if that is an outward-looking and progressive society framed by legislation that encourages its development, then this legislation, if we get it right, in a small way can send out that message. Hopefully the Minister will work with the committee if we believe changes should be made to strengthen the bill and make it appropriate for 21st century society. Gurmila Maog of Cam Corla.
Call Mr Jonathan Bell.
Thank you, Mr Speaker. Today's legislation, which the Minister has given a comprehensive overview of, will probably be some of, if not the most serious legislation that we will deal with within this mandate. And that's not hyperbole. Alcohol-related deaths for 2014 was 238. Alcohol-related deaths for 2013 were 236. Now, if I compare the 2014 figures for alcohol-related deaths at 238 with the road death statistics of 79, and we see a 300% increase. Now, if we were to come to this House with the outrage that we rightly have for road deaths, and we were experiencing a 300% increase, we would be looking, by accelerated passage or whatever way we could, to bring forward legislation to do something about that. But yet, almost slowly, imperceptibly, we have allowed to continue the real danger of alcohol in our society, the deaths that it is causing, the severe mental health effects that it has, the severe physical health effects that it has, and we almost walk blindfolded year by year by year, ignoring what has occurred. I spent over two decades in professional practice. I have seen the effects of alcohol on individuals. I've seen the increased risk of both suicide and suicidal ideation. I have witnessed the Royal College of Psychiatrists inform us that alcohol is our favourite drug. And interestingly, Mr Speaker, one very senior medical person in Northern Ireland said to me today that if alcohol was to come on the market today, there would be serious concerns over whether it would be issued with a license. So we're dealing with something very serious. So it's not hyperbole. We're dealing with something that in the last couple of years of 13 and 14 has taken 474 lives. And literally into the tens of thousands of physical health effects and mental health effects of people. So in a way, the legislation that we're dealing with today is real politics, and it's affecting real people. And we have to be very judicious about how we take this forward. I don't excuse the pun. We have to be incredibly sober as we look at all of the facts that are brought before us. And the minimum bar for me, and I think for the House as well, should be that whatever we do in terms of our legislation, almost like the Hippocratic Oath, our legislation must do no harm. In fact, our legislation should be about the reduction and indeed the prevention of that harm. Personally, having seen the effects in professional practice in the health service, I would have come from a very simple point of view, that extension of opening hours, of changing arrangements, that on one hand looks like it will allow for more alcohol-related harm. My gut reaction was that we shouldn't do it. I'll be absolutely straight with that. I've seen too much, and my gut reaction was we shouldn't do it. That was a simple response. Having considered all of the evidence, it was a wrong one. Because I believe the bill which the Minister is bringing forward will actually lead to a reduction in alcohol-related harm. It goes further than just trying to hold it to where it is, to actually reducing it. And I'll develop the points as I go along in this piece of legislation. We do have to tackle some of the practices within the licensing trade. It is imperative that we regulate both the sale and the supply of alcohol in Northern Ireland. And critically, and what I love about this bill, is it strengthens the protections in relation to children and young people. It doesn't take away any of the protections that currently exist. All of those protections for children and young people are maintained. And the bill then goes further. It strengthens the protections that are available for children and young people. And the reason I say that, Mr. Speaker, is... Yep, sure.
Way on that point, and I agree with him that it is important that we consider about how children and young people are introduced to alcohol when that happens. Would he agree with me, though, that in many other countries where alcohol is more available to younger people under the supervision of their parents, they actually have less of an alcohol problem than we have, where it's absolutely prohibited for them to be in a place where alcohol is served?
The member makes a very interesting point, and I have two views on it, which aren't necessarily contradictory. I looked at some of the evidence from Belgium. I can remember being out on business and noticing that into the early hours of the morning, they didn't appear to have the alcohol-related problems that we have. And when I asked some of the Belgian politicians and also some of the community representatives, why was this? They made a similar point, the one that the Honourable Member has just made. They said that children in Belgium will grow up with alcohol, with beer in the fridge. They will very often, the way we would normally say, well, do you want some tea or coffee? If you're looking for a mortgage or you're consulting your solicitor or you're speaking to your bank manager, in Belgium they will say, well, do you like some tea, coffee or beer? It's just manner. However, they did make the point that young people are taught from a very early age of the danger alcohol causes. I am very loath to go fully with what the Honourable Member has said for these reasons. All of the medical evidence that I have seen is saying that a child's body goes through puberty, the pubescent child, the adolescent, there is really no argument that allows for a safe amount of alcohol for the child given their physical development. And I think we've got to be very careful about that, because alcohol affects, in medical terms, all of us at different stages.
I thank the member for being so gracious as to give way a second time. The point I was making was not to be clear that I want children to be able to drink, because that's not my point. My point is that children in such places can have a moderating influence on adults' behaviour. For example, you'll very rarely see the kind of behaviour that you often see outside a pub happening, for example, at a family wedding, because there is a moderating influence of having younger people around throughout that event, and people moderate their intake as a result.
Apologise for picking the member up wrongly the first stage, and yes, I do agree with that moderating influence. I have to say, Principal Deputy Speaker, that's the first time in 6 years in the House I've ever been accused of being gracious, but I respect that. Thank you. Let's then move on to addressing some of the concerns that very legitimately exist within our hospitality industry. Some of which the Deputy Chair of the Committee has outlined. I have spoken at reasonable length with both the representative bodies and also with individual retailers, suppliers, whatever the proper term is within my own constituency. I have to say, when I look at the voluntary code, the regulatory code that Hospitality Ulster has developed, I see professional men and women of the highest standard in Northern Ireland who don't take the attitude of let's make the biggest buck and the devil take the hindmost. When I look at the code that they have developed, I can see in it an expertise, a genuine appreciation of the health issues regarding alcohol, which I will outline further, a genuine commitment to the society that they serve. And it ultimately makes sense for the likes of Hospitality Ulster to develop that excellence, because they know that if we get this right and if we get this legislation correct, that the future long term for the hospitality industry can only grow, and the future benefits in society can also grow. And when I look at different bodies, not just Hospitality Ulster, Colin Neil, Michael and Cofola's, Newton Ards, Old Cross Bar, and listen to what they do in terms of first aid, in terms of personal safety, in terms of protecting young people, protecting females, what they do in terms of ensuring proper transport for people. I see people that are in this industry for the long term. I see people operating to the highest standards of integrity, the highest standards of integrity in our hospitality industry. And I'm very proud to represent them and their commitment. Sure.
I thank the member for giving way. And he made the point earlier about the alcohol-related deaths. And of course, we should be concerned about those. And he's outlined the role of Hospitality Ulster and the code in terms of moderating within pubs and clubs alcohol consumption. Is that not an argument why we need to ensure that the more harmful practice of drinking at home, the cheap alcohol in supermarkets, that we need to ensure that we support this industry to ensure we promote responsible drinking and reduce that alcohol-related harm?
Yes, I mean, I think the Minister has outlined already some of the responses to what you've said in terms of the harmful drinking and how patterns have changed over time. And that's why the Minister has referred to both advertising and where advertisement is placed. And that's why I think what the Minister's outlined in allowing children to be part of functions where there's more safety, more protection, that moderating influence that Mrs. Long referred to is so critical. But what we must do is we have to stop, realise we have sleepwalked into a situation where we are quite happy, not quite happy, we're almost ambivalent to the facts of hundreds of deaths 300% more than on our roads, and do something to contribute to a reduction in alcohol-related harm. And that's why I believe it's not an easy thing for the Minister to take forward, given some of the difficulties I'll outline shortly in terms of alcohol problems that the medical profession will tell, the psychiatric and psychology professions will tell. But to do something that has a genuine chance of reducing alcohol-related harm. And that's why I think it's a courageous piece of legislation for the Minister to take forward. I know the difficulties that there are with this. I know many of the views that are taken. I think when you look at an evidence-based approach, informed by medical knowledge, informed by best retail practice, informed by the alcohol consumption habits of people in the in 2016, and we know that some 73% of our population, just short of three quarters, consume alcohol in Northern Ireland. 76% of men, 70% of women. So we're talking about legislation that is directly relevant to over three quarters of our population. And I appreciate the honesty of people when they have informed us of binge drinking and their personal binge drinking habits in Northern Ireland. I will be the last person, I think the good book is absolutely correct, judge not that ye shall not be judged. I'm not going to stand in judgment of anybody, but I do appreciate the honesty that people have brought forward. And they have told us that 31%, or basically one in three, of people in Northern Ireland, of that three quarters who are taking alcohol, are binge drinking. 35% of males and 24% of females. And binge drinking, I'm talking about for a man, 10 or more units, 5 pints. For a female, 7 or more units, or 4 medium glasses of wine, to try to put it into some form of perspective. I would also say to you, as somebody who had a background in psychology, and I think nearly any nurse, doctor, mental health, social worker out there will also tell you that most people are not, how do you put it politely, Principal Deputy Speaker, entirely truthful about their drinking habits, for a number of reasons, societal pressures, individual pressures. So with what we know and what we can reasonably assume to be an underestimation of the difficulties that exist, we know that 31% of that three quarters of our society in Northern Ireland are binge drinking to a harmful, a seriously harmful effect upon themselves, and of that, 11% of those who are taking alcohol in Northern Ireland have an identified severe alcohol problem. So that's why I appreciate the courage of the Minister in taking this bill forward. We committed to do it personally in our own DUP run-up to the Northern Ireland Assembly, because we saw the need to change legislation to better society, to be less harmful to individuals. If I was bringing forward a bill that said the pressures on our National Health Service, and we all know the pressures that exist, and I know the pressures that exist in my Strangford constituency due to, particularly in accident and emergency departments, due to alcohol-related harm. And those pressures in health service, if anything, are going to increase. I know in my own constituency we're preparing for a new town the size of Ballinahinch every 25 years, just with the success of our health service in combating mortality. But we also know that with that increased population, we are going to deal with more problems with morbidity, and we have to do something to try to alleviate the pressure within the health service. Now, if you were bringing forward a bill, and the Minister was to say, I can bring forward something that can lead to 12,010 person reduction in admission to acute hospitals, I think we'd all be cheering. On every side of the House, we would be cheering. And we have to acknowledge again the reality that in a period you can have 12,010 people in our society being admitted to hospital with an alcohol-related problem. It's impossible to quantify the cost in both human terms, in mental health terms and physical health terms, damage to families, damage to society, breakdown in families, domestic violence, all of those issues related to alcohol-related harm. But a useful guide is that alcohol excess is costing Northern Ireland somewhere in the region of £900 million every year. So that's why I say to people that look to simplistic solutions that seem to suggest, Principal Deputy Speaker, that just reduce the hospitality industry, don't change anything out of fear that you'll be accused by not changing something, you will have increased the problem. It would be disingenuous of a minister not to bring forward a bill if all of the evidence coming before was that with the changed drinking habits of 2016, here are proposals which have been examined, which have had the expertise fed into them, and have the potential to contribute to a reduction in alcohol-related harm. That has the potential to reduce those 238 deaths a year that I can find from 2014. That has the potential to reduce the 12,000 admissions to our acute hospitals with alcohol-related harm. And it has the potential to save some of that £900 million that we're currently spending in Northern Ireland and use that money for a better purpose. Now, as we go through the bill, and members will, I know, have gone through the 27 clauses, they'll probably be delighted, I'm not going to take them all individually. But there are reasonable grounds, and I ask anybody not to take a knee-jerk reaction to what is being proposed and look behind at the bigger picture. And in some of those clauses, there will be a review in 12 months. So nobody's saying this is a blanket issue that we'll just make and legislation. This legislation will be reviewed. And if we find out that the legislation is not doing what we believe it will do, which is reduce alcohol-related harm in Northern Ireland, then we have the opportunity to change that legislation. But members, if we are in a position where we have the opportunity to change legislation to the betterment of an individual, a family, children, our health service, the costs and the mortality rate associated with alcohol-related harm, if we have the potential to do it, then we need to take the courage and go ahead and do it, regardless of some ill-informed criticism that may come about. Now, what we do know in the trial period of allowing the drinking up period. Now, the drinking up period, we all know alcohol is affected by, affects your judgment. It'll lead you to take greater risks. So what is happening is somebody whose judgment is affected, and I'm not standing in judgment, I'm just talking reality, and they hear the call for last orders. What happens then, and we know by practice, is that there is a stockpiling of alcohol. People are buying an excess alcohol that if they had the time, they wouldn't possibly drink. If they had a space where they could wait for their taxi, wait for to get home safely, then they wouldn't stockpile. Now, the hospitality industry has been very clear that they're concerned about the stockpiling. Not because they can make more money out of people stockpiling, but they know long-term the danger of alcohol-related harm in Northern Ireland is quite literally unsustainable. We can't go on at the situation that we're in. So allowing that 30 minutes to 60 minutes of a trial period is allowing people and giving them a clear indication there is no need to stockpile. And you shouldn't be stockpiling at a time of large of the evening, early hours of the morning, where your judgment is impaired and you cannot make a proper decision for your own health, both physical and mental, as to how much alcohol you need. You're responding to the fact somebody's put a time frame on you. No, you don't need to do that. You don't need to stockpile, and you don't need to drink that amount of alcohol in that short period of time. So that is a reasonable and proportionate response that has at its background ensuring security of both the individual and safety and also the long-term interest. Because, let's face it, and I have two teenagers growing up, we live in an alcohol-saturated society. I just, in preparation to debate, just took a brief evening just on television, the amount of alcohol that was either advertised or was in terms of dramas and soap operas and films, the amount of times that young people watching, all of us watching that, almost perceive this is a norm. This is, yes, it's alcohol-related harm, but it's a norm. So don't do anything about it. Let people continue to die. Let society continue to suffer. Let the National Health Service, look, this is a norm. Everybody does it. Therefore, we do it as well. And that's where we need to really address for young people with the damage that alcohol does to the pubescent body, to inform them in advance of the danger it's going to do to them, the potential harm to their physical and mental health, and then do what the Minister said, put strict regulations in place to ensure that those young people can have access to the music, can have access to the school formal. It's, you know, two teenagers, I know what the importance of the school formal. I'm a governor, I know that young people, and it's a very good and healthy development of them as largely as they progress on to whatever they're doing the next stage of their life. But allowing that to happen in an alcohol-free and safe environment is the right thing to do. It's saying to young people, yes, you can have a good time, but you do not need the danger of alcohol and the harm that it can do to you. I think what the Minister in the Bill has cleverly done is also in self-service and vending machines put a prohibition on alcohol in self-serving and vending machines. That way we can have some form of regulation, we can have some form of control, we can have responsible people, in many cases trained people in basic first aid, in charge of the sale of alcohol and can ask for the ID. Minister, that prohibition on self-service and vending machines for alcohol, I think, will critically, over the next number of decades, be very beneficial to young people because it will allow control, it will allow proper care, and most importantly of all, it will allow proper responsibility. And if we have our professionals properly trained, and I know of no one, I haven't spoken to, there's people more expert in this, but I've spoken to dozens of people in the hospitality industry, and I know none of them that are not prepared to refuse alcohol to a young person if it's illegal, if that young person doesn't meet the grade. So not allowing young people to self-serve or use a vending machine for alcohol, maintaining that prohibition, is a particular piece of excellence, I thought, within the bill. And let me turn to the code that I mentioned earlier. That's the responsibilities under the code that Hospitality Ulster have developed themselves. Because let's scotch any idea, probably the wrong pun again, of the hospitality industry only being interested in profit. Hospitality Ulster, Hotel Federation, many others that I've spoken to, particularly in relation to this bill, are very clear they're looking for a long-term, viable future for their industry that is sustainable and that is healthy. I think the Deputy Chair outlined very well the importance for the tourist industry and the hospitality industry of the local hospitality, the local product, and the people that are running those local industries are often families and generations of families, and they know too the long-term interest for their business is responsibility and contributing to a reduction in alcohol-related harm, while at the same time ensuring that people who are coming to Northern Ireland, who are enjoying our hospitality, can also enjoy the excellence of the food and drink offering that is available. That responsible retail code that Hospitality Ulster developed, that their members voluntarily signed up to, I find when I talk to them that really what they want in the bill, and I raised this at committee, is that we give teeth and we want to was Skinner's theory of classical conditioning, always reward good behaviour. Here is an industry that has behaved intelligently, has developed a code, that has self-disciplined themselves to that code, and are now looking to all of us to give that hospitality Ulster code real teeth. And I believe that that bill will allow for real teeth to be given, and where we can have an approval and a code of practice that has legal consequences, that does look at the promotion, the retail and the service of alcohol. Let me say, people have raised the issue of Easter with me. I think Easter has a special, special significance to Northern Ireland. I believe personally it's the highlight of a particular year where I remember the death and the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. I know there's other people of different faiths and of no faith who don't share my views. But I find when I talk to them about this importance of Easter to Northern Ireland, that I don't get dismissed. I don't get a cavalier attitude, well, you think that and you might believe that, but we don't, so let's get on with it. What I'm hearing when I've spoken to people about how we address the issue of Easter, and yes, we'll allow on Thursday the normal procedures that apply throughout the rest of the year to apply within the bill. But I hear respect. And I want to tell all those people out there that don't share my beliefs, and I hope one day they will, on the death and resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ and its significance, that I deeply appreciate the respect that they've shown for my faith and also the significance of Easter to a huge amount of people within Northern Ireland. And I appreciate their tolerance and I appreciate the sensitivity with which they have approached this, and that's why I believe the protection of Easter and its maintenance within the bill is particularly critical. I mentioned earlier, for children, all certificates remain in place. We're not reducing anything for children or young people. We're maintaining everything and we're enhancing the protection within the bill. I value within the bill that both the liquor and the entertainment licences will run concurrently. And I understand this will help the police service deal with and uphold the compliance with the law. I want to say a special word of thanks to the police service of Northern Ireland. I'll thank, hopefully, towards the end, the ambulance service, the paramedics, the nurses, the A&E staff, the hospital staff. But I remember watching how the police, what is a very difficult issue. Remember that historic night in Northern Ireland walking from Belfast city centre up to Windsor Park, Northern Ireland were playing Greece. And, well, we all know the brilliance of that night. I'm not sure we all fully appreciated it. At about 5 o'clock that evening, it was going to be as good as it was. And I had the opportunity to watch police policing thousands of people, literally thousands of people, sometimes only two or three at a time, different spots of the city centre, all the way out to Windsor Park and back again. And I saw policing in Northern Ireland that was at its best. I saw person-centred policing. I saw police helping people who had taken too much to drink. I saw police making sure people got the proper levels of first aid. I saw police helping people and ensuring that within those thousands of people that throng in all the celebrations, people that were disabled, people that were in crutches and different things, I watched the police at the highest level of service. And I didn't see any difficulties. It's not a word of surprise that I'm sure Brother Humphrey will remind me that the Northern Ireland fans get the best fan award in Europe and have subsequently been re-awarded what they obtained more recently after the Euros. But I watched the police comply the licensing laws, to uphold them, to protect them, but to do it with the utmost sensitivity and do it in what are very difficult circumstances of tens of thousands of people. I'm not exaggerating, tens of thousands of people that were both on the streets and going towards the match and watching in bars and clubs and different things. And I watched them do it with sheer professionalism. And that's why I like the fact that we are responding to what the police are saying, and we're going to bring the liquor and the entertainment licences together to help the police and assist those brilliant men and women to uphold the licensing law in a professional way, but also in a very person-centred way. I do think the Minister is correct not just to go to a blanket ban for 2 a.m. I understand he'd be criticised on all sides, and some of us who were ministers know that it can be a very difficult and lonely place to be, because when you seek to do what's right, and my apologies to John Buin, his brilliant book in Lord Castlereagh, if I've got this quote wrong, but he referred to Viscount Wellington as saying that you have to do what is right for people, sometimes more than what people want you to do. And I believe the minister in the bill has got it absolutely right. There will be a demand for a blanket extension to 2 a.m. in the bill. And I can understand where that's coming from. But I think it's right because the minister has a responsibility to society in Northern Ireland and not just to the industry to take a judicious approach. And I think the allowance of up to 1 hour extra on 12 days with the protections for Easter and Christmas and everything else built in is proportionate, is reasonable to the demand, contributes to the overall balance of reducing alcohol-related harm to Northern Ireland and not to the extension of alcohol-related harm in Northern Ireland. I hope it gets the support in the bill of every section in this House for the bill in terms of what it seeks to do as a measured approach with the aim of reducing alcohol-related harm in Northern Ireland. And let me turn to a very insidious, disgusting industry that has developed in Northern Ireland. I think Mrs. Mullen and others referred to it when we were in the committee. And that is the issue of taxi drivers supplying the alcohol to minors. Minors who know that because of the professionalism of the industry at off-license standard, when they won't supply alcohol to young people, there are those in our society who, for a quick buck, are prepared to buy the alcohol for them, often sell it on to the young people with an increased profit, and provide young people with alcohol that's going to seriously damage their developing bodies and affect their physical and mental health. Sure.
Would you not agree? And I think when you make a statement like that, you have to quantify it, because the vast majority of taxi drivers are good, decent people out to make a living and do not take part in the practice of the talk.
To underline everything that you have said, everything. The vast majority of taxi drivers are, my constituency is the exact same as yours, overwhelmingly responsible. But I think both you and Nicola and myself, both when we looked at this in the committee, we realised that there are some people, a minority, as a member correctly corrects me, I didn't mean it to come out like that, but if that's the way it came out, I stand corrected. That minority of people, not just taxi drivers, but people using their own personal vehicles, that minority who are supplying alcohol. And I think that's where the Minister has sought to identify a problem of 2016 and to deal with it accurately in the bill. And that is the requirement that we will make, and we will check all taxi drivers and those who are delivering alcohol, that the reception of that alcohol cannot be by a minor. And that allows, that logbook is a very clear warning gone out that we will stand with, as the Honourable Member McCann says, we will stand with all of those responsible taxi drivers and everybody else who refuse to engage in this abusive behaviour. And we will require the logbook to be held, because we want to ensure that young people, we stamp on this practice that is going on. And I have talked to police in my own constituency. There are concerns about public venues, public parks. Largely, we've tried to tackle it as best we can, but when we do deal with community safety, what we do know is that there are young people gathering with alcohol, taking serious levels of alcohol, ending up in our A&E wards, and that alcohol, it would appear,
from anecdotal and other evidence, has been provided to them by adults. And that alcohol sometimes has come out of, whether it's a personal vehicle or whatever vehicle it is, the boot of that vehicle to those young people illegally, and the people practicing that trade know they're doing it illegally. And we're on to them. And we serve warning to them that we will check those logbooks, and we will check to ensure that the alcohol that is being provided, if it is being transported, has a proper log and that no minor can receive that. And I think that is responsible. And let me turn to the issue of advertising. Advertising must be reasonable and it must be proportionate. And we do know that, you know, at times alcohol can appear, when you look at some of the more expensive bottled waters, sparkling waters, alcohol appears cheaper. What message are we sending out in our advertising? Particularly when people, and we referred to children earlier, come in with their families to a supermarket and they're hit first with an offer, perhaps a loss-leading offer. They get people in on the balance that they're taking a loss on the alcohol, but they'll make that profit up in terms of the food and everything else that is retailed. So it is right that we keep, we don't let children walk through the alcohol aisles. And we do that for very, very good reasons. We're not going to create a society where we're telling children this is a norm, this is okay, walk through the aisle, it's just like picking up a Coca-Cola or picking up a bottle of water. It's not. You're dealing with a very serious drug. And that is why we should, if we're not prepared to allow children to walk through the alcohol aisles, we should then follow the logic of that, which is that we shouldn't allow children to see the advertisement in supermarkets and other places, in other parts, that would take away from that message of this is a serious matter and should only be dealt with by reasonable and responsible adults. And that's why I think the advertising within the bill that the Minister's brought forward about where advertising can be placed, that it has to be kept within the alcohol areas, that in boundaries and other areas, the regulations are there, that we can protect young people and make them aware and take away from them the power of advertising the serious drug that they know will cause them physical health and harm. I do support the fact too that within the regulations and clubs, and again let me be very clear, I know from my own constituency, I know across Belfast, many the responsibilities are taken seriously by people that are running those clubs. And I think it's right that when we do promotions and things, we make it clear that that is for the member of the club. Now I think it's also reasonable, and the law currently allows for, where there's a charitable or where there is a benevolent purpose, that we can allow people in for that charitable or benevolent purpose. That's a measure of responsibility and reasonableness, but on the other terms, where it is for the club, it is for those club's members only. And I do think that for within sports clubs, and I have seen sports clubs do a tremendous job for Northern Ireland. My own children participated in many of them. I watched for years as my own son went through to captain Ards Rangers from a period when he was in primary school. And there are a lot of better skills in football than his dad. But I watched as those sports clubs taught young people a lot of personal responsibility. And I watched in Ards Rangers where they could have up to 300 young people two nights a week and in different matches on a Saturday morning and afternoon. And I watched them help young people with their personal development. And those of us psychologists who believe in the link between physical fitness and mental fitness, watch them develop at all aspects of their educational career. And I think it is right that we look at those summer months and we allow the young people to be part in one occasion on a calendar year to be part of their sporting club with all the protections that are there. That is saying to people, we're not taking a blanket, unreasonable approach. We're going to enhance the protection to young people, but we're going to allow them the full range of benefits of their sports clubs. which I think if we were ever to put a value on, would be worth millions of pounds to Northern Ireland with all the volunteers that exist within those clubs. And so what we're doing is we're recognising the value of sports clubs, we're enhancing the protection to children, and we're allowing them on one occasion to participate within their club. But let me go back to why we need the bill. Alcohol, according to the Royal College of Psychiatrists, is our favourite drug. Let's be very clear on that. Alcohol is our favourite drug. Not my observations, not the observations of research, but the detailed report of the Royal College of Psychiatrists. I'd encourage people to take a read at that report. It's available on the internet under Alcohol, Our Favourite Drug, Royal College of Psychiatrists. Because we need to waken up to the fact that while we live in an alcohol-saturated society, alcohol does more harm than illegal drugs. Alcohol does more harm than illegal drugs. When I talk to teachers, I talk to youth workers, and I'm involved in some voluntary youth work myself, there seems not the level of understanding of alcohol as being more harmful, factually more harmful than illegal drugs. Alcohol is more harmful than cannabis. It has done more harm in Northern Ireland than heroin. So that puts a perspective into what we are actually dealing with. So as I conclude, we look at the affecting of judgment of alcohol. The risks that people will take in Northern Ireland when they've abused alcohol. The arguments that they will enter into that they wouldn't normally enter into. The financial trouble that families experience as a result of excess abuse. Sadly, the family incidents, the violence, the harm, the verbal abuse, the domestic violence, in cases of sexual abuse, irresponsible sexual behaviour, the increase in accidents in roads, at home, in water, or on a sports playing field. All of those are telling us this bill is absolutely necessary. And I go beyond the mere severe hangover that people talk about as being the punishment they experience for alcohol. I look to the medical evidence that's saying, yeah, but not only do you have a severe hangover, you're also likely to have the gastritis and the stomach pains. You'll have the vomiting. You can go into unconsciousness. And we know in Northern Ireland you can experience death. Before we deal with liver disease and the increased risk, both you and any future career that you may have. As I conclude with the mental health problems of the proven links to depression, to both suicidal ideation and sadly suicide itself, to the loss of memory, to brain damage, to the hearing of noises and voices that aren't there. That's why I say to all the members of this House, I would have taken, as I approached it, a position that, look, let's not do anything. Let's look, it's bad enough as it is. Let's be careful. On examination of the bill, on examination of how it has the real potential to reduce alcohol-related harm in Northern Ireland, to protect Easter, to allow young people not only to have all the protections they currently experience, but to have those protections enhanced. With 236 deaths plus in Northern Ireland, this bill, its time has come, and I believe it should have the support of everyone in the House, Principal Deputy Speaker.
Well, Andy Allen.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker. I'm pleased to speak on behalf of the Ulster Unionist Party on the second stage of the Licensing and Registration of Clubs Amendment Bill 2016 and indicate our support for the bill's progress to committee stage. I will state clearly, however, that the bill as currently presented does not go far enough and needs amended. I believe that the purpose of this bill should be crystal clear. It should be about modernisation of Northern Ireland's liquor licensing laws. Modern licensing laws, intelligently implemented, could actually help to alleviate problems, plus help revive the nighttime economy in many of our provincial towns and villages. Principal Deputy Speaker, this is the first bill of this mandate and the first which the new Committee for Communities has been tasked to scrutinise. As a relatively new MLA, I have in the recent weeks researched the whole area of licensing laws in Northern Ireland and the background to this new bill. There's been over 12 years of false starts, false promises, delays and disappointments. However, as the Minister has outlined, this bill, as presented, does contain some useful improvements to the law. However, there are gaps in the legislation as presented. No mention is made to the microbrewery licensing, dog tracks on a Sunday or minimum pricing of alcohol. Whilst I recognise here in Northern Ireland some progress has been made, albeit at a slow pace. In 2007, former Minister Margaret Ritchie piloted a bill which ended up in Licensing and Registration of Clubs Amendment Act Northern Ireland 2011. This was a short bill which covered areas like closure of licensed premises and clubs, penalty points, proof of age, irresponsible drinking, promotions, pricing, authorisations for special occasions. However, this was to be the first stage of a process. The second stage never progressed in terms of further legislation under previous ministers from 2011. What we had under former Minister McCausland was another consultation process in 2011, which eventually led to a press statement made during the summer recess in 2014 promising new legislation. However, no legislation emerged before the end of the last mandate. According to Hospitality Ulster, this version of the bill, which has now been brought forward, is less impactful than the draft bill, which was written a number of years ago and does not reflect recent changes in consumer or industry trends. One change which I would like to briefly highlight is the growth of microbreweries developing local homegrown draft beers and ciders. At present, these local companies are being massively restricted by our licensing laws, and there is nothing in the bill before us to give them any help whatsoever. They cannot sell their wares on their premises, nor can they avail of the opportunity to sell their produce at farmers' markets or shows. Surely now is the time to introduce a new category of licence to permit small breweries to apply for permission to sell at source. I'll just finish these points and I'll let you in. As well as options to apply for occasional extensions to sell at local events. Happy to give way.
Thank you, Mr. Allen. The member would agree that I think in conversation in the Communities Committee there has been agreement across parties in terms of the need to address the issue regarding microbreweries. And had the Minister sought in legislation at this juncture to address that issue, that would have entailed an entirely new consultation process. Actually, there's nothing to prevent the committee from bringing forward an amendment in terms of dealing with the issue in that way. And as I say, I don't think there's any disagreement in terms of the issue that's been highlighted there and the need to address it.
I thank the member for his intervention, and I will come to that. And I recognise that the committee, there's broad support there for microbreweries, and that's why, again, I raise it here on the floor. Given that the BBC Good Food Show is happening at the Waterfront Hall in a few weeks, this is an issue which should have been dealt with long ago. Microbreweries licensing is something which I hope the committee can come to a consensus on in terms of future amendments, as is the whole issue of Easter opening and wider opening hours for licensed premises. The detail of this is something which the committee can get its teeth into, but suffice to say, we really need to look seriously at this issue and take this opportunity to make the law fit for purpose. Madam Principal Deputy Speaker, many in this Assembly will say that alcohol is a social evil and so an unacceptable burden is placed on the NHS. I absolutely agree that there are many problems associated with alcohol abuse. However, those who say that the answer is enforcing highly restrictive practices on the hospitality industry are getting it completely wrong, in my opinion. As Hospitality Ulster have pointed out, the problem with alcohol abuse cannot be laid solely at the doors of licensed premises. The Department of Health, which has already been mentioned, 2013 survey, which showed that 65% of alcohol consumption happened at home, with only 20% in a pub and 17% in a restaurant. I believe firmly that we need to support our hospitality industry. Surely we should all be trying to help our hospitality sector and the tourist trade. In closing, Principal Deputy Speaker, I commend the Minister for bringing forward this proactive bill, and I look forward to working with my colleagues in the committee to improve the bill. Thank you.
Éirim Saoire, Claire Hannah. I called Claire Hannah.
Thank you, Madam Speaker, and I'll try and be brief. I know there's a lot of speakers. I don't want you to have to call last orders on me, and Nicola Mallon will outline our thinking more fully shortly. The SDLP do support this bill because our licensing laws are in very dire need of reform, but we hope it will go further by amendment. I do commend the Minister for being out of the traps this early in the mandate. I think it was frustrating for many people that on this issue, as on several others, we ran out of time before the election, so it's good to see some movement. Updating these laws will have a very positive effect on the hospitality sector, which is vital to our wider tourism and economic pitch, but hopefully it will also be a small factor in encouraging our own, you know, brightest and best young people to stay here as well, because people are frustrated that they don't feel that they can use their leisure time as they want to and as they would elsewhere. We agree very much that a lot of people in this society have a very unhealthy and destructive relationship with alcohol, and we believe that this reform actually can assist with the regulation and control of alcohol to that end, and hopefully reduce some of the antisocial behaviour associated with binge drinking. So we do support that as a stated aim of the bill, but we will say it is absolutely not just down to the licensed premises, but it is easy to see that longer drinking hours don't necessarily result in more antisocial behaviour. And if you want a case study, you can go and look at almost all of mainland Europe that has much more liberal licensing laws than us, but do not seem to have the same level of antisocial behaviour, unless people from these islands are over-visiting. While in Department of Social Development, the SDLP did initiate consultation with a view to reforming licensing and did achieve some liberalisation on licensing around clubs. And I see that the department did a public consultation in 2012 and received over 2,500 responses, which I imagine is reflective of the urgency, even though that was 4 years ago, required by the sector, as well as the frustration of many members of the public. As other members have outlined very thoroughly, it's estimated that just approximately one-fifth of alcohol consumption is done in pubs, with some 80% of it taking place in private homes, the private home of the individual or somebody else's home. As such, it's unfair to place almost the entire regulatory burden on the venues that account for 20% of that consumption, as well as the fact that pubs can be considerably more controlled environment. I'm actually licensed by Lambeth, a personal license holder in England that's attached to the individual and not the pub for something in a former life, and I did have to go through a lot of training and exams on licensing to be a designated person, and there are a lot of burdens on most license holders and pubs here take those very seriously in terms of selling to underage people and selling to intoxicated people, and they are strict and stringent, and a lot of that regulation is available in pubs and certainly not in private homes. It's the below the radar drinking that we really yes, the member will give way.
Thank you for giving way. Would the member agree with me? I asked a question of the Health Minister in July with regard to underage drinking and hospital admittance and treatments, and sadly the answer was that there were no statistics for underage drinking. And I do agree with yourself with regard to the burden of responsibility being within being borne not just by the proprietors but also the departments. And would you also agree that there needs to be a closer working relationship departmentally between the Departments of Communities and Health to look at this issue in particular, where we're not collecting statistics to address the problem properly?
I do agree, and I think that is worrying if we don't have information. Unfortunately, underage alcohol consumption is visible to any of us when we are out, and I'm sure as elected representatives we hear about the negative effects of that and we try and mitigate. So it is worrying if we don't have the statistical basis to help us tackle that. But actually it is the societal relationship with alcohol, and in fact we can use licensed and controlled licensed premises to demonstrate how alcohol can be consumed responsibly. The Minister and others have outlined the provisions of the bill regarding Easter. It will permit a normal opening hour the Thursday before Good Friday. We do support this, but we support it being enhanced and extended. Easter is, for many of us, a time for family, a time for reflection, a time for religion, but we can't tell everybody that they have to sit in their home and reflect all weekend. It is a bank holiday weekend, and many people will find it literally ridiculous that they can't have a glass of wine with their lunch on a bank holiday Friday. And I believe Hospitality Ulster quantifies it at about 16 million loss to the sector. It's an important tourism weekend as well. And people might go home and say, well, yeah, you know, it was good, but we have to go home at 11 o'clock and they won't encourage people to come back another weekend. Concerns have been expressed in the media discussions about this, about staff not being able to have that weekend off. And yes, I think it is nice that there's shutdown time for everybody, but I'm very comfortable that that can be accommodated within individual businesses and in the framework of existing labour law. Additional hours, this is a reasonable change, but we understand that licence holders, many of them, will want a dependable year-round licensing framework that will assist them with their staff planning and with marketing and so on. Drinking up time, this one is actually the key, I think, to reducing the antisocial behaviour that we do see on our streets in the wee small hours, and as the member outlined, that it will discourage people from stockpiling and stocking up and double rounds and so on just before last orders, and it will crucially stagger, and I do pardon the pun in that case, it will reduce and I suppose spread out the amount of people on the street at closing time seeking taxis, seeking fast food or whatever, and some of that does frequently lead to antisocial behaviour. Children's attendance and functions and the related provisions, and that will be explored by colleagues later on. This issue has also been well aired recently in the media, and it is very appropriate that we regularise the ways in which premises can be used that do sell alcohol can be used, because they don't just sell alcohol. In many cases, they do have a wider social function.
I do thank the member for giving way. Indeed, at least two premises within my own constituency have been hit with this bulk in the legislation, which actually creates more of a problem. I heard Mr. Bell referring to the taxis delivering drink, where you have young people in a controlled, monitored and supervised environment. I feel that's much, much better than on many occasions roaming the streets with drink, maybe bought by other adults for them.
Absolutely, I would agree with that, and it is, as I say, it is an opportunity to show younger people how alcohol can be consumed, and there are far many more protections that we can give than when young people are getting together in a bandstand in a park or wherever they are. Additional issues that we hope can be incorporated and have been mentioned by others as well by amendment: provision for microbreweries. Craft brewing is a growing industry here, and actually it's something that very much promotes quality over quantity, so it isn't about firing a whole load of alcohol into you, but the legislation in this area needs to be amended to allow breweries on their premises or at trade shows to sell the product. These beers don't have the big networks that other ones have. If people like them, they can't say, well, get down to Tesco and, you know, buy a whole load of it. And actually this came up, the major BBC Good Food Show that's coming to Belfast next month can't operate here the way it will elsewhere, where people can sample alcohol-related products and buy them to take away. This was flagged up by the industry in January or February. The show takes place next month in October, but this executive did not have time to respond. That is an issue where we royal prerogative would have come in handy, and I think people will be frustrated that it's only used to help the executive part and not to help the wider sector. Also, I remember we had a blip in 2011 when Belfast City Council put on and supported the MTV Music Awards, and that was supposed to be about a big pitch to, you know, event organisers that Belfast and Northern Ireland is a suitable venue for your big events. But as it was on a Sunday, it was lights out and bedtime at midnight, and there was no flexibility and there was no ability of the council to respond to that, because it was supposed to be a big sales pitch to a lot of those. I'd be happy to give away.
The member will be aware that in mainland GB, in many places, there are 24-hour opening hours. I assume the member doesn't want South Belfast, the constituency that we both represent, to become like Blackpool at the weekend.
You assume correctly, and the member has in no way called for, and I think that's the point. It's not absolute liberalisation, 24 hours, or what we have now. There are very many positions between the antiquated licensing laws that we have and one that is fit for purpose. In fact, there's various bodies of evidence on how that has and hasn't worked out. I have said I think people do have a poor relationship with alcohol here, and as I say, when you're on the continent, the natives are enjoying a quiet beer at 1 o'clock in the morning. It's the British and Irish people that are going hell for leather and causing all the trouble. So I don't think it's just the licensing hours. It's other things. But no, and we haven't at any point called for 24-hour licensing in this. I would be happy to give way.
Grateful to the member for giving way. Could I ask the member, twice she's made that point, to desist for labelling everyone that sort of behaviour when they're in the continent, because the member will know that the Northern Ireland Sports and the Republic of Ireland Sports both received awards, and they may have consumed some alcohol, and I was there at one of the games and saw it being consumed. I may have consumed some myself, but they didn't behave in the way the member. They did not behave in the way the member has just outlined to this House.
I'm happy to respond to that. If you, I don't think anybody here is going to judge you for having a drink on your holidays. But this reinforces my point. It's not the licensing laws. In those places where they were celebrating, alcohol was available. It doesn't have to mean that everybody's going to lose the run of themselves. So that's why having a regulatory framework that implies that if we open the pubs a little bit later, we're all going to lose our minds is a problem. And that's why we can get the balance correct. In summary, this is both an economic and a social issue. The hospitality sector provides 60,000 jobs and over $1 billion to our economy, as well as the fact that it is time for our laws to come into the 21st century and reflect how people consume alcohol. This is Northern Ireland's year of food and drink. Discover NI have a big flagship promotion to support our growers and our brewers and our cooks and so on, but we are in ways holding back this sector. Of course we need a robust regulatory framework, but you know, we can't put all the burden just on the licensed premises that are so important to our economy. It is also a societal issue. As I say, we do have societal problems with alcohol, which feeds enormous pressure on our health service and other public services, and nobody absolutely is denying that. But we are here to develop evidence-based policy, and the evidence simply isn't there that that's all coming out of the licensed sector, and it simply isn't there. And I think the member has shown that because pubs are open later, it doesn't mean that people will act in negative ways. So it's right that we use the evidence, and we use it to, now that this bill has finally come forward, make it as strong and as useful as possible.
Call Naomi Long.
Thank you, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker, and I'm welcoming the opportunity to be able to speak on this Licensing and Registration of Clubs Amendment Bill. I think it's a long overdue step in terms of trying to benefit our tourism and hospitality industry in Northern Ireland, and so I welcome the fact that the Minister has brought it before the Chamber today. We recognise that alcohol is a controlled substance with the potential, when it's abused, to cause significant damage to the health of the individual and to cause public nuisance or disorder. We're not therefore seeking, nor is the industry seeking, complete deregulation. However, the majority of alcohol, it is recognised now, is consumed at home. Up to 70% of the alcohol that is drunk in society is consumed at home, where there are absolutely no limitations on what people can drink. There are no safe measures made. There is no one to intervene and say that someone has had enough, and there is no going home time because people are already there. So the issue around public health is more to do with trying to get people to have a responsible attitude towards alcohol, rather than simply constraining those who are already drinking responsibly in the hospitality sector and in bars and clubs. Purchasing cheap alcohol and drinking it at home, either because you're staying at home or before you go out, is a much bigger challenge, actually, than what people are consuming in pubs and clubs. And much of the difficulties that we see in society are, and that have been reflected by members who have been speaking, are not as a result of people drinking in bars and clubs and licensed premises. They're actually as a result of people drinking off sales, either where they shouldn't be or at home and with no supervision or no control over that. And I think we need to take that into account. I welcome the restrictions that the Minister has discussed with regard to advertising in supermarkets, because I do think impulse purchases are a real challenge in terms of the health demands that we're looking at. But I do think that there is a wider issue here, both in terms of advertising and indeed in terms of how we integrate children into more adult environments. We need to better educate our young people to move away from a binge drinking culture towards responsible drinking. And the best way to do that is to demystify alcohol, not to make it something that people are rushing to get that is forbidden and that becomes a big deal for people to be able to get their hands on it. There's nothing like telling people through the power of negative persuasion that something is not allowed in order to encourage a young person to want to do it. And so the more we can integrate young people into environments where people are drinking responsibly and sensibly, where young people themselves and their presence there actually moderates behaviour in those circumstances, the more healthy I think our attitude towards drinking will be. And I think that's reflected in terms of how, for example, when you go to the continent and you see young people sitting in bars with their parents, with their families, it curtails the tendency for adults to overindulge in alcohol, but it also demystifies the issue of what happens in a bar, what happens in a pub or club, and what alcohol is about. And young people on the continent are much less likely to resort to binge drinking in those countries where that is the norm than they would be here. So I think that there is a genuine issue in terms of how we actually get that balance right, so that we aim for responsible drinking and that we better educate young people. The difficulty, of course, is that what we risk doing is punishing the licensed trade for problems which are not of their making, which are actually to do with what other people are doing outside, whether it is the rogue taxi driver who takes the drink to young people in the park or whatever it may be. We shouldn't be looking at those issues as part of this, because it's not licensed traders that are the main problem when we're dealing with this. Actually, the licensed trade and the hospitality industry have not just, I suppose, an opportunity, but also have a vested interest in trying to ensure that people drink responsibly, because to do otherwise could risk their license and their livelihood. So far from, I think, trying to put overweighty restrictions on licensed premises, what we should be doing is ensuring that when we have those restrictions in place, that they are sensible and that they are properly enforced. And I think that that is the best way to ensure that those who have licenses are responsible in how they deal with alcohol and encourage their patrons to do likewise. For the last number of years, the Alliance Party has called for licensing reform in Northern Ireland. That was demonstrated, I think, just last year when my colleague Judith Cochran made small but significant amendments to the alcohol licensing for the three national stadia in Northern Ireland. Just as that private members' bill was a common sense approach to licensing, removing a lack of certainty that accompanied applying for occasional licences, today's bill, I think, represents an opportunity not only to modernise our licensing laws, but also hopefully to simplify them significantly, that will restore the faith of licence holders, brewers and the general public in the ability of this Assembly to respond to their needs. Madam Deputy Speaker, I don't want to list all of the changes that the bill will bring. However, the most pertinent, I think, are modest increases in the opening hours, particularly over the Easter weekend, modest relaxation of licensing rules, a modest increase in opening and drinking up hours, which I think are welcome, and also for certain licensed premises, there will be restrictions on the advertising of intoxicating liquor. All of those things are things that we, I think, in general, can support. We do believe, however, that this bill could go much further in terms of the reforms that it brings forward of our licensing laws and address, particularly, I think, emerging areas of growth in the sector. As it currently stands, I think it is a foundation to make a significant stride forward and support the tourism and entertainment industry. And I hope that the Minister and his team will be open to amendments that may come either from the floor of the Chamber or through the committee to try to improve the bill as it goes through its scrutiny stage. The hospitality industry is worth £1.1 billion to the Northern Ireland economy, and there are 60,000 jobs reliant on it. So it is important that we respond to the needs of that industry, and particularly given the constructive way the industry has engaged and the responsible way that it has addressed what it wants to achieve. I think that there are a number of things that I would mention in terms of what could be done. In terms of licensing, we have a number of challenges, I think. First of all, with respect to the Easter weekend, which is always the one that people focus on, for the obvious reason that from a tourism and hospitality point of view, it is almost the exception in that it is a four-day bank holiday weekend and therefore from a tourist perspective is quite important. There has been a modest change made to the Thursday prior to Easter and to the drinking time there. However, what it hasn't done and what the bill has failed to do is to simplify the opening hours over that bank holiday weekend, or to make any increases that would make a significant difference in terms of the perception of tourists who come here for that period of time. I recognise, as other members do, the importance of Easter as a Christian festival, and I think it is important that that is respected. However, if people do not wish to avail of licensed premises over that weekend, they are, of course, free not to do so. What this restriction tends to do is to lead to people drinking over the Easter weekend in their own home, which is precisely the behaviour that is problematic in terms of health. So, people who want to drink will drink anyway, but they will do it at home in less controlled circumstances. People who don't want to drink won't have to regardless. So for me, it is about trying to get that balance, and I think it would be possible to extend the hours, to regularise them in a way that makes it simpler for the industry and less costly, and also more easy to understand. And that's one of the other things that I want to raise, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker. In general, I think we need to simplify licensing so that both those who run licensed premises, the police and the councils who have to enforce those licences, and the public themselves are clear when it comes to what licensing hours they have and when they can and can't drink and their drinking up time. Because at the minute it is a bit of a hodgepodge with series of entertainment licences and late licences and so on. And it's much more difficult both from an enforcement perspective but also I think from the perspective of the public to respect the licensing laws if they're not really sure what the rules are going to be when they set out for the evening. I think there is work that can be done on that, and I would hope that the Minister would be open to listening to the case that others and myself will probably put to him over the coming weeks and months. In terms of supermarkets, there is also an issue in terms of supermarkets purchasing the licences of former licensed premises solely to use the licensing certificate of owners. This can lead to a switch from people having a local pub in a small village in a rural neighbourhood to that licence being transferred to a large supermarket which is only interested in off sales. There is an issue, it is a contentious one, about the fact that no additional licences are created in Northern Ireland. To change that has implications for those who are licence holders because it devalues their licence itself, and so there is an implication for them. But to not change it is a constraint in terms of expansion of the industry and permitting growth of new business, particularly in areas where that business might thrive. So you can have licences essentially being bought from rural areas where pubs are struggling and then transferred to more urban areas so where those businesses are sustainable, but that can have a knock-on effect in terms of local communities. And I think that the release of a small number of new licences each year may be one solution that should be considered and at least investigated as this bill goes through. I think there's also an opportunity to shift some of the powers of the courts to local authorities as part of this bill in order to streamline processes for licensing and to save considerable amounts of money when it comes to how licenses are handled. I believe that councils generally are effective and efficient in their licensing processes, and it may well be that they can handle some of the more routine matters that currently require a publican to go in front of a magistrate. And I think that should be considered as a way of trying to streamline the process. In terms of the, current bill, and it's already been referred to as the issue of microbreweries and craft distillers in Northern Ireland. It's a rapidly expanding sector, and it is one that I think has the potential, given Northern Ireland's reputation for outstanding food and drink. I think it's one that we have the potential to grow much more rapidly in the future and which deserves support. As others have mentioned, there are reasons why it's not been included in this bill. I think 4 years ago this was much less of an issue. But it's worth noting that currently the only distiller that can allow you to taste and then purchase on site is actually Bushmills. They're the only one that has a licence that will allow them to do it. And to do that, they must have a full bar licence and to be able to have a full off-sales licence. So they have to have a full licence for that. I think there is an opportunity here to create a class of licence that would allow people to sample the wares of craft brewers and craft distillers and then to purchase. I mean, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker, when people go abroad, for example, and they visit places like Napa Valley or Hunter Valley, they go, they taste the wine, they visit the vineyards, and they buy a bottle of wine. It is what people do. They purchase the local produce, and it's one way of bringing it home as a gift for family and friends. We want people, when they come to Northern Ireland, to purchase things that are uniquely about us, that are benefiting our local economy. And one opportunity to do that is for them to visit one of the craft distillers. I mean, particularly the gin distilleries, which have grown up over recent years, but also craft breweries. I mean, I have three in my constituency, Boundary, Knockout, and... I've gone blank. I've got three in my constituency, and I've spoken to them of late, particularly with respect to this element. And for many people who come to Northern Ireland on a short break or even on a business trip, to be able to take something home that is uniquely about the place they have visited is much more meaningful than them actually just taking some kind of other souvenirs home. So I think that there is a real opportunity for us to be able to support local business, support entrepreneurial activity, and encourage people to be able to sell their wares. I think there's also a need to look at the issue of artisan fairs. People have talked, for example, about the food and drink event, but there are also things like craft fairs, there are things like artisan fairs and so on, where people could sell their wares but currently under law can't. And I think that needs to change, because we are not talking here about the kind of go-to alcohol purchases that are problematic in terms of society. If people want to drink to excess, they are not buying craft beer and craft gin in order to do it. And so I think we need to be aware that this is potentially a growth industry. It's counterintuitive not to create that opportunity, and so I think it would be useful to specifically have a licensed class that would allow people to do that. The other issue which has also been raised is the one which affects Drumbo Racecourse, and it has been caught between two pieces of reform. Initially, there wasn't a need for it to have a licence on a Sunday because you couldn't gamble on a Sunday. Now you can gamble on a Sunday, you can go and have a meal on a Sunday, but you can't have a glass of wine with your meal because there is no licence for it. It's a very small change, but it would make a significant difference to the business, and it is one that I think we should be considering because it seems again counterintuitive to constrain a business that could otherwise grow by preventing that from happening. Madam Principal Deputy Speaker, on that basis and on behalf of the party, I want to support the bill, and I look forward to assisting it on its way through the committee. I do hope that the things that have been raised in the chamber today by members of the committee are ones that the Minister will be open to considering and will give thought to, because I think it is important, given how long this has been in gestation, that when we actually pass this piece of legislation, it is something for the future. And not something that is already dated before it is even enacted. So it's important that we are at the very front of what we want to do, and that we are actually doing something which is modernising and simplifying a business which is of huge importance to the Northern Ireland economy. Thank you.
Paul Adrian McQuillan.
Thank you, Madam Principal Speaker. Madam Principal Speaker, can I thank the Minister for introducing the licensing and registration of clubs bill and welcome it moving forward to our licensing laws in Northern Ireland. It's hugely important in growing our hospitality industry, and I have every confidence that we now can see this bill through to its final stages and have fully implemented in Northern Ireland. The bill was introduced as a result of public consultation, in which over 2,500 responses were received, and this shows the vast public support for change to our licensing laws. I welcome the change to the Easter opening hours to allow later hours on the Thursday before Good Friday. Currently, premises and registered clubs with additional open hours are allowed to stay open to midnight. However, with this provision, it will mean the late opening on a Thursday before Good Friday will be the same as the late opening available to any other weekday in the year, which is 1 a.m. We realise this may not go as far as the licensed trade would like. However, I think it's a step in the right direction. It's important to take into consideration the balance between the licensing trade and the health and well-being of our constituents. I'm disappointed we have not yet made any provision for the inclusion of microbreweries in the bill. However, I understand that when this bill was first drafted in 2012, microbreweries were not as popular. There are currently over 30 microbreweries in Northern Ireland, with them becoming increasingly popular in more recent years. The craft beer industry is continually growing, and I feel this is also an important aspect of tourism in Northern Ireland, as it introduces something new and local to our tourists. Craft breweries have been a popular tourist aspect in the UK for a number of years now, and there are also many craft brewery tours in England, which I feel we could introduce here. However, there needs to be a relevant legislation in place to allow visitors to buy the product at the end of the tours. Breweries are not currently included in the 13 categories of premises which are eligible for a licence, which prevents them from being able to sell at source. Visitors can take tours of the microbreweries and sample the produce, but when it comes to the end of the tour, the visitors cannot purchase the produce and they have previously sampled. This is counterproductive, stunning business opportunities, job growth and tourism. Many of these microbreweries are home brewing from very small premises, and the ability to sell at local farmers and markets and festivals would allow for better business sustainability. I understand that if the breweries were big enough and had enough money, they could purchase an off-sales licence to sell their liquor. Mm-hmm. However, most microbreweries are co-ops and do not have that cash flow to facilitate this. This lack of legislation affects my own constituency, with the Cara Brewery in Port Royce, which I visited back in February as the First Minister. And when Minister Given is next back in my constituency, is somewhere I like to take him to show it firsthand the negative effects of not having the relevant legislation in place. I also welcome the proposals to allow under-18s on licensed premises, providing alcohol is not available. This will enable hotels to provide a safe and controlled environment to hold events such as teenage discos and school formals. This will help sustain hotels' income during off-peak season, providing more jobs and boost the local economy. I welcome this bill to the Assembly and hope that we as MLAs can see it through to provide a fully functional liquor licensing bill, taking into consideration the hospitality sector and the health and well-being of our constituency. Thank you, Principal Speaker.
Eirms of Fran McCann. I call Fran McCann.
I'll get the pre-last Cam Corla. And like Adrian, I'll try to be brief on things. Comments, because I do believe and think that we have a number of other opportunities to come back here and to discuss this and debate it throughout the committee. This has been a much anticipated piece of legislation, and I have no doubt over the next few weeks we will hear a wide range of opinions and listen to the experts on the important decisions this Assembly needs to make when dealing with the sale and consumption of alcohol. We have been advised by the Department that the purpose of this bill is to bring legislation which will place restrictions on the advertising of intoxicating liquor in supermarkets and off-sales premises, introduce occasional additional late opening for certain licensed premises, and will include modest changes to the Easter opening hours for certain licensed premises and registered clubs. Will extend drinking uptime for a trial period of 1 year, and will align intoxicating liquor and entertainment licenses to licensed premises and allowed late opening. It will also remove the requirement for children's certificates in licensed premises and registered clubs, permit underage functions in licensed premises and registered clubs as long as certain conditions are met. It will require licensed restaurants to display the conditions of their license and will place a requirement on delivery people to record the details of identification shown if there is any doubt that the person might not be over 18 years of age. The bill will also permit the formal approval for codes of practice on responsible retailing. It will also make minor changes to the law affecting private members' clubs. Very modest proposals indeed. I've been on this committee for some years, and our party have always argued that whilst we need to deal with all the problems thrown up by the sale and consumption of alcohol in terms of health, scenes of excessive drunkenness and antisocial behaviour, we also need to look at the impact the legislation has on wider society. In fact, we as legislators need to ensure that we find that happy medium which deals with the above problems, but also recognises the rights of citizens to enjoy all aspects of social interaction, mm-hmm. much of which is usually connected with the provision of entertainment, the sale of food and the sale of alcohol. We have all seen on TV the ugly scenes of public disorder, some aspects of the sale of alcohol has in people and communities. We have also heard the dangers to health of consuming alcohol, and we have heard the cost to our health service and the cost of treating the after effects of alcohol abuse. And again, we as legislators need to look at ways this can be dealt with. But again, we have to take into consideration the best way to move this debate forward. I have been concerned for a number of years that we have not effectively dealt with this issue. In fact, we seem to have taken one step forward, then two steps back, when it comes to the way this has been handled, certainly in my time on the committee. We need to find that happy medium again, but in doing so, we also need to recognise what people want from us in terms of legislation. We will also hear over the next weeks of an industry which is in the business of providing places of entertainment, hotel accommodation, restaurants, bed and breakfasts, registered clubs, who provides tens of thousands of jobs and who provide increasing numbers of tourists, which is fast becoming one of the success stories of our economy and which brings in an estimated £1.1 billion annually. And an industry which has been told continues to modernise, but says the legislation has not been modernised to meet the pace and to deal with the changing circumstances, something I don't believe a late-touch approach or what the Department Minister calls modest proposals will bring. The changes required to meet these changing circumstances. If we fail to grasp it at this time, then we will be back in this chamber in another few years. Speaking of missed opportunities, legislation needs to recognise the changing society in which we live. It needs to recognise that almost 70% or more of alcohol is bought in supermarkets and off sales and consumed at home. They also estimate that 22% of people drink at their home alone. These are frightening statistics. I believe this is where the main problem exists, and the only proposal we have in front of us is to ban advertising of alcohol 700 yards from a shopping complex. Carja, this is the battle we need to win, and this is how we deal with the increasing consumption of alcohol at home. I understand from figures supplied from Lobby Letters and Hospitality Ulster that just 20% of alcohol is consumed in pubs, 16% in restaurants and 9% in hotels, which we are told is a heavily regulated environment. And we're making any decisions like that, I do believe that we need to take that all into consideration. There is no control over the sale of alcohol in supermarkets and shopping centres and off sales. People can go freely, at least within the confines of the places I spoke about. There is a direct control, there's a professionalism, and there's a will to move this forward. I know that even over the Easter period in the past, and I would live close enough to Belfast City Centre to be on it quite regularly, and when you meet tourists and other people who would be in the city centre to eat over the Easter period, who find it difficult to be able to socialise, to be able to tap into the entertainment that our countries can expect 52 weeks a year. I do believe that there are other anomalies in the legislation which needs to be dealt with, but not least, and Naomi mentioned it, there's a whole question of the Drumbo racetrack. Also, the prohibition of young people going to entertainment within licensed premises, and not least, I do believe that the whole question and around microbreweries and what they can offer in terms of employment in the future. Thank you.
Christopher Stalford.
Madam Principal Deputy Speaker. Madam Principal Deputy Speaker, I think in terms of the constituencies that be directly affected by this legislation and by its, the problems that it seeks to address, I think my own of South Belfast probably ranks very high up the list, because on any given weekend, you can see the problems that are associated with the excessive consumption of alcohol, particularly in the city centre. I welcome the fact that the focus that's driven forward these measures is protecting local communities and the interests that they have. And I do sense, actually, and I think this is a good thing, that there is around the chamber a broad consensus in terms of the direction in which people want to go. There might be some differences in terms of emphasis, but I think there is a broad consensus, and I've sensed that in the committee. I therefore was a bit disappointed when my constituency colleague, Claire Hannah, seemed to set up some straw man arguments and then knock them down again. There were arguments that actually neither the minister nor anybody from these benches had been making in terms of the licensing regulations. I think it probably it might be a source of disappointment to some people that the arguments that they were anticipating being made have not actually been made, and that the legislation that's been produced by the Minister is a rounded piece of legislation that strikes a balance, an important balance between promoting jobs and growth in the economy, but also in terms of protecting young people in particular, but also protecting wider society. In that vein, I welcome various measures that are contained in the draft legislation. I welcome the fact that we will be banning vending machines that dispense alcohol. I also welcome the fact, however, that the ancient and noble tradition of the school formal will be allowed to continue in Northern Ireland because of the measures that have been brought in, where it had previously been under threat as a consequence of the existing regulations. I'm pleased that the Minister has taken action in relation to drinks promotions, and I welcome this. I also welcome the fact that the phenomena of sort of dial a drink or dial a carry out is to be tackled. As has been said numerous times by many members, we need to take action in this area. I'm pleased that there is agreement across the committee that more must be done to help microbreweries and craft distillers. I think there is agreement in that regard, and I agree absolutely with what the member for Belfast East, Mrs Long, said with regard to the tourism value and the tourism potential that those outlets have. I think that that is something that can be uniquely Northern Ireland. Yes, I will.
Forgiving way. I just felt that I had to mention Yardman because I went blank at the time, and I don't want anybody in the constituency to think I'm favouring one brewery over another, and I'm sure they would welcome you to come and visit them as well.
Well, I'm not going to pass comment on where and when the member for East Belfast drinks, but I'm sure it would never be before she gets to her feet in this place. I think it's important that we recognise this as a potential growth area for the economy and for tourism. And I'm pleased that the Minister is in, or I hope he will, the Minister will indicate a preparedness to work with us to accommodate those establishments in the new legislation. I do listen sometimes to some of the contributions that have been made, and it almost makes continental Europe sound like some sort of utopia where everything's open all the time and everyone's allowed to do whatever they want, but they all do it moderately and everyone gets along terribly well. I think we need to be slightly more realistic about that when everyone's holding up the great continental model in terms of how to do things. And I'm not saying that just because I'm an anti-federalist. I do think we need to be a bit more realistic and a bit more reasoned and grounded in the arguments that we make. I'm pleased that it was acknowledged that complete liberalisation and 24-hour opening is not a path that people want to go down. I'm pleased to hear that, and I'm pleased that people recognise that actually increased liberalisation of opening hours does present particular challenges. And I, for one, I welcome the massive uptake that we've had in tourism in this city over the course of the last 15 years. I think that's a good thing. But I, for one, would hate to see Belfast or Londonderry or any other part of Northern Ireland become the way that some of the seaside resorts in England have become, where people come to some of those places for hen and stag weekends and they just absolutely ruin the town and they ruin the reputation of the town. They make idiots of themselves and they make life miserable for the people that live there. We all want tourism. But we want tourism that brings with it benefits to the community as well as there are more important things sometimes than just money, and I think it's important that we use this as an opportunity to... Yes, of course.
In light of the member's accurate remarks about the dreadful effect that overconsumption of alcohol can have in certain places, would he agree that there is a contradiction, an anomaly, lurking in the chamber at the moment in that we are discussing during what hours alcohol can legally be sold, while at the same time in our society there is an absolute restriction on the possession, much less the sale, of the relatively benign, harmless, non-existent drug cannabis? Shouldn't that be resolved at the same time as we decide on the opening hours for pubs and clubs?
Well, the members, I was going to say he's at perfect liberty to bring in private members' legislation in that regard, but he's not anymore. But I'm certain that if the member was to bring a motion or what have you before the House on that, I'm sure there would be a full and varied discussion. I think he probably knows what side of that discussion I'll be on in terms of I don't support the legalisation of cannabis, but I recognise, obviously, the very negative impact that alcohol can have upon our society. I also recognise that there is plenty of evidence to demonstrate that cannabis is not a benign substance and it does have a negative impact upon people who use it frequently or for any, over any sustained period of time. Yes, I will.
I appreciate the member highlighting that because much of the professional medical, psychological and psychiatric opinion is what the member says. Well, we're speaking on licensing today, Madam Deputy Speaker, and I have raised the dangers and the increased dangers, according to the Royal College of Psychiatrists, of alcohol over cannabis. It should be remembered that cannabis is known as the gateway drug. It does lead to mental health problems, particularly among young people. So to send out the message that this is harmless is not only wrong, but has a potential to significantly damage young people's mental health.
I thank the member for his point, and he's obviously much more qualified in these matters than I am. I think it's probably better that we, through his professional career, Mr. Kennedy, not through consumption, if I could. I think Mr. Bell now has grounds for a defamation action. I think we recognise that this legislation is a positive step forward. I think there is a genuine spirit, not only in the committee, but around the chamber, to bring this process to a quick conclusion in terms of putting in place a framework that allows for the expansion of vital tourism sectors, but also protects wider society. I commend the Minister for bringing the measures before the House, and I look forward to working not only as a member of the committee, but with all members around the chamber in seeing them progress. Thank you.
I call Nicola Mallon.
Thank you, Madam Deputy Principal Speaker. While a new member to this House, I am aware of the deep sense of relief, particularly within the hospitality and tourism industries, that this bill is finally making its way through the Assembly, and I want to pay tribute to the Minister for bringing it forward so early in his tenure. As many of the members in this House have pointed out, the purpose of this bill must be to modernise liquor licence legislation whilst still working to reduce alcohol-related harm. Absolutely no one, especially within the hospitality sector, is making the case for deregulation. And therefore, the fear of a leap to deregulation should not cloud consideration of the merits of any amendments which might subsequently come forward in respect of this bill. If we are serious about joined-up government, then this bill should seek to make the licensed trade offering more sustainable and attractive to tourists. This is a strategic objective that is necessary if we're serious about meeting targets in relation to tourism income and about delivering the 50,000 jobs related to this by 2020. As this is only the second stage of the bill, the Communities Committee, as Mr. Stalford has pointed out, has not yet had time to reach a considered and agreed view on any amendments it intends to collectively bring forward. But I do think that it is fair to say that there is a degree of consensus emerging, but it is certainly not for me to preempt that discussion or that process. But from the SDLP's perspective, in recognition of the critical role the hospitality sector plays in shaping the visitor's experience, and also by providing a controlled environment in which to consume alcohol, we would be in favour of extending opening hours, increasing the number of nights applicable under additional hours-late licences, and also increasing the extended hours-late licence per year beyond what is currently proposed in the bill. This is certainly not to advocate or to create a situation where we have 24 access to alcohol in clubs and bars, but these increases would be intended to moderately and modestly build on those proposed by the Minister. In respect of the anomaly affecting under-18s at functions like school formals, the SDLP welcomes the proposals contained within this bill, permitting the attendance of under-18s at functions and licensed premises, provided the bar remains closed. We are also, however, sympathetic to the amendment being suggested by Hospitality Ulster to allow under-18s to remain in licensed premises after 9 p.m. when attending a family function. I think it is unnecessarily harsh to send a 16 or a 17-year-old, for example, away at 9:25 at a father or a mother or a grandmother's birthday party where there are responsible adults and family members there. I certainly think that that proposed amendment adds a helpful degree of common sense in a responsible manner, which is, I believe, the balance that we should be seeking to strike in this legislation. I think it is important when we're talking about responsibility to acknowledge and recognise the great strides made within the hospitality sector to promote the responsible sale and consumption of alcohol. The industry itself, as many members have pointed out, has voluntarily led the way when it comes to developing and implementing an industry-wide high standard code of practice. And I welcome the fact that this bill intends to give statutory recognition to this effort and the industry code of practice, which provides a model, I would argue, for other industries to learn from. While the SDLP's current thinking is to welcome key aspects of this bill and expand on others, we also believe that a gap within the legislation exists by the fact that it does omit, presently, the licensing of craft breweries and distillery premises. In doing so, I would argue that it fails to recognise the unique bespoke offering that many microbreweries and distilleries offer within the industry and in terms of enhancing our tourism offer. This point has received much consensus during the debate today, and I look forward to seeing it being shaped and it evolving as the bill moves forward. Certainly.
Sorry, just adding to that, thank you to the member for giving way. Just in talking about the industry and up to date, and obviously with craft beer, you rightly point out there's agreement across here, there are barriers there, but there's also reflection of the actual outputs of sale and looking at online sales as well as a new venture for a lot of those industries, and it may be worth looking at in that new context about online sales of alcohol as well.
Certainly, I agree with the member, and I think it is something that we need to take a serious look at to reflect the reality of the current situation. I think I have to agree with Mr McCann as well. The anomaly and the omission of Drumbo Racetrack is another matter that I think we should explore further as this bill progresses. As members who have spoken before me have rightly pointed out, some 70% of alcohol in the north is consumed at home. In a vast number of situations, this is fine and poses no problem as it is taken in moderation. But in other instances, it is much more harmful. And I can understand then the rationale for a debate around minimum unit pricing of alcohol. In my own constituency, and I know that has been referred to a number of times throughout the debate, we do have the very harmful and illegal phenomenon of dial-a-drink, as it is known. I certainly think that this is something that needs to be tackled more robustly, because I don't believe that enough is being done to tackle it, considering the very harmful nature of this activity. Madam Deputy Principal Speaker, we cannot possibly address all of our concerns in relation to the harmful overconsumption of alcohol within this bill. But what I do believe this bill must do, it must modernise our outdated licensing legislation, and it must do so in a way which supports and encourages the consumption of alcohol in a controlled and safe environment. Yes, of course.
I thank the member for giving way. Just on the aspect of modernisation, given that Hospitality Ulster has made a case for the modernisation of legislation to include one extra hour for the sales of alcohol two nights per week, perhaps it may be useful later on and through the workings of the bill that the department via the minister explain why he's only proposing to allow an additional hour for the sale of alcohol on 12 occasions per year. What's the basis for that rationale in that decision or proposal? Thank you.
Thank you, Mr McGlone, and I'm sure that's something that the Minister will take time to explain in terms of the rationale in the bill as it is currently proposed. In taking some time to outline the SDLP's current thinking on amendments, and undoubtedly we will bring others forward as this progresses, we really do take the approach that we are seeking to get the right balance between having a robust and attractive hospitality and tourism sector, but also ensuring that we do what we can to reduce the harm of drinking, and particularly where that is drinking in the home. We look forward to considering this in the committee, and I also, and we look forward to working with the Minister as we shape this bill going forward. Thank you, Madam Deputy Principal Speaker.
Éireann Sir Stephen Agnew. I call Stephen Agnew.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker. In this bill and the discussion around the issues of alcohol, we have to balance personal freedoms along with the need for public health and safety. Certainly in at least one aspect of the bill, we have to look at the respect for religious practice against the right to freedom from religion, as well as freedom of religion. For me, I hold the pillar of personal freedom very highly. I think we should only restrict personal freedom where we can demonstrate through sound evidence that there is a need to do so for reasons of public health and safety. But I believe the difficulty with our licensing laws as they currently exist, and indeed as they would exist if this bill was passed unamended, is that there are still significant restrictions on personal freedoms without the evidence that it does what it purports to do, which is reduce alcohol-related harm. Because Jonathan Bell spoke at length and I think took his extra half-hour wind-up time, allowed it for in the bill. But I think he did highlight the dangers of alcohol, and let nobody stand up and say that alcohol is a benign drug without getting into the debate about cannabis. I don't think anyone would make the point that alcohol is a benign drug. We know the harm it does in our society, and Jonathan Bell read out the figures, the number of deaths each year, and we know as well about the impact on families, the alcohol-related acts of domestic violence. I don't want to stand up here and say alcohol cannot be harmful. However, that does not necessarily justify the restrictions that there are in our licensing laws unless we can demonstrate that those restrictions actually reduce that harm. So I put that out there, and I think that's why this is a bill coming from the Minister of Communities. But we do need the input from health. We do need, in terms of crime and public safety, the input from the Department of Justice. And in the 4 years since the initial consultation in this bill, I would hope that evidence gathering has taken place, and perhaps the Minister will allude to some of it as he winds. And also, these will be the types of questions as a member of the Communities Committee that I'll be teasing out as part of the deliberations on how, because I do support the bill coming forward today. I welcome it. It has been a long time coming, but to be fair to this Minister, he has acted very quickly in bringing forward what's the first piece of significant primary legislation in this Assembly mandate. So I welcome the bill, but I do think it needs my significant amendment. And as a member of the committee, I will be hearing the different briefings from the industry, which has been alluded to a lot. And I think it is important we look at how we support our tourism and hospitality industry, absolutely, but also how we support the constituents who elected us, who do enjoy their evening social life and don't feel that it is the government's place to tell them what time they should finish drinking and what time they should be home and in their bed by. So if we look at some of the key provisions within the bill, we have, I think, the welcome proposal to have extending open hours. But again, the restriction that be limited to 12 days a year. And that to me, again, without maybe knowing some of the evidence the Minister has available is how that helps improve public health and public safety, why 12 days was chosen, why such a restriction, why not more frequently, and certainly to me it would seem reasonable that that even if that was common practice on weekends, that that could be something we should be looking at and look at maybe normal weekend practice. But again, I've not set views on this. I'm open to hearing the evidence and to hearing the debate. I welcome the half an hour extra drink up time. It's a year trial. I don't think this is going to see the decay of our civilization. So I suspect it'll be a successful trial, and I hope it's something that after the 1 year that the minister is open to extending. The fact that it's in there, I'm taking that as read, to be fair to the minister, that he is open to that, and I hope the 1 year trial becomes something that becomes normal in future. Easter opening hours are something that has caused much debate, certainly in radio phone-in programmes. They've certainly caused much consternation, again, within the industry, but also, again, by our constituents who want to enjoy the extended bank holiday weekend and to do so in licensed premises. And I alluded to it at the start. I fully respect the religious views that exist within our society and the right for people to uphold religious practice and customs. But I don't see where those who do not subscribe to those values in any way infringe upon those who do by themselves consuming alcohol in licensed premises, as opposed to at home, which is clearly what takes place instead. So I'm not sure. I don't fully understand the need for our restrictive licensing laws over Easter. I welcome the small step that's been made in extending the opening hours for the Thursday before Easter, but I think we can and should go further than that and normalise the licensing laws for the Easter weekend. I have some concern, and again, I have no set position on this at this point in time, but I've certainly concern about the proposal to align entertainment licences with liquor licences. I think had it, I suppose there's two ways you can do that. You can align, you can move liquor licences to entertainment licences, and I'd have perhaps been more positively disposed to that. Instead, we've went the other way, and we're seeking to further restrict entertainment licences. And I think a lot of the drive behind the need to reform our licensing laws has come from those who want to see a degree of liberalisation, or as the terms often used, modernisation of our laws. This proposal runs contrary to that. And again, I will listen and hear the evidence as to why feeling the need to do that. The minister made reference to assist the police. I have not seen the briefings from the police that says this is necessary. So I will look at those, I will listen and make a decision. But my instinct is that this extra restriction is the wrong direction of travel. I think there has been, and that's maybe a counterexample, where there is arguably a simplification in aligning entertainment and liquor license, although as say, from my view, moving in the wrong direction. But overall, I think there's been a strong call and a justified call to simplify our licensing laws. I'm not sure that the bill meets that challenge. And I again, through the committee, happy to interrogate how we can perhaps do that on a wider basis, because it's undoubted that our licensing laws are complicated. And I'm still very unclear as to what some of them are, having researched it. So those who haven't had cause to look into our licensing laws in great detail can only be confused. And an example of maybe where we're further complicating things is, and reference has been made to it, the requirement on restaurants to display and signage when and what circumstances they can and will serve alcohol. And I think the Minister made reference to restaurants acting like bars. And again, I'm interested to see why we need that distinction in our licensing laws, why we feel the need to have so many different categories of license. I think, as I said at the outset, this bill is a long time coming. It's to be welcomed, even if the detail that I would like to see, the progress that I would like to see, isn't all contained in it, at least as a vehicle for change, for debate, and for modernisation of our licensing laws. But I do see it as baby steps, and I hope over the course of the passage of this bill we can grow up a lot when it comes to how we regulate and license alcohol sales in our society. So I do support the bill's progress, but I hope it will see major reforms before its final stage. Thank you.
Eamon McCann. I call Eamon McCann.
Thank you, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker. I think that one of the questions, one of the issues which arise from this debate is this. What is it about our society which causes so many people, and particularly young people, to want to get out of their heads over weekends and indeed during weekdays? The point has already been made, but it's worth underlining. You can't walk through any of our city centres late at night or early in the morning at weekends without seeing squares and streets and city centres carpeted with young people out of their heads on drink. That's a very interesting question as to why that happens. What is it about alcohol sort of which leads that to happen? I believe that, you know, that needs investigation, and it needs medical and social evidence to be brought before us before we can make a determination as to what conclusion shall be drawn from that. Let me make it clear that I'm not saying this in any killjoy sense. I support the bill. I would go further. I see no reason for restrictions on the sale of alcohol or indeed of anything else that's not going to that's already legal in some circumstances. I can think of no argument why the hours shouldn't be expanded and people should be prevented from exercising their choice. But I do say this, that when we are discussing the availability, when we can have available mind-altering substances, and that's what alcohol is, when we are discussing this, we must see it in the round. I see no point at all in isolating alcohol from other drugs. And incidentally, we heard it said here during the debate that cannabis is a gateway drug to more dangerous drugs. No, it is not. There is no evidence. When I say no evidence, I mean none whatsoever for this proposition, despite the fact that it is trotted out over and over again by people who claim to be experts. I ask them to produce the evidence. I ask them to examine the situation in Portugal as between alcohol, which is actually sold on a non-restrictive basis on Portugal.
Wait, did that give away?
Yes, they will. Yep.
I did previously actually work in the field of community drug and alcohol awareness. The evidence that I saw was actually the gateway drugs are tobacco and alcohol, not cannabis.
Absolutely. I mean, fortunately or unfortunately, in my career as a journalist and simply sort of growing up and living in this society, north and south, I can say that I've known quite a number of people who sadly were addicted to heroin. Many who died from heroin. I had a good friend and a flatmate who died from heroin, wanted to get off it but simply couldn't. He began on alcohol. I have never known a junkie who didn't start on alcohol before they went on to heroin. I have never known a junkie who went on to heroin as a result of smoking cannabis. I will tell you what the connection between cannabis. There is a connection, therefore, between alcohol, which we are discussing here, and harder drugs. The connection between cannabis and harder drugs is this. But cannabis, unlike alcohol, is illegal. In order to get your hands on cannabis, you have to go into murky territory outside the law, where all sorts of other substances might be offered to you, particularly by the people who are selling you cannabis. Now, he said, when you compare that with alcohol, and incidentally, the idea that there are people whose health has been harmed with cannabis is absolutely true, of course. Any mind-altering substance is bound to do you harm.
This is the second stage of the bill, and can I ask all members to stick to the principles of the bill rather than departing into another debate?
OK, I will do, of course, Madam Deputy Speaker. I think we might come back to the other subject that I was alluding to, and might I say that had it not been that there's a restriction on the introduction of private members' bills, there would have been a bill along the lines that the member referred to before this, and there will be before this session is over.
I appreciate what the Principal Deputy Speaker has said, and it is part of the debate that I mentioned earlier, and I accept what the member said, and I have said in relation we need this bill. And I've used the evidence of the Royal College of Psychiatrists to say that alcohol is more harmful than illegal drugs. But I would make the caveat, and this is available from the NHS UK, that cannabis will damage your mental health, will give you an association, a link to schizophrenia and other psychotic illnesses, damages your fertility, your ability to drive. That's NHS evidence.
Can I remind all members we're debating the licensing bill, and the debate that you're entering into at the moment is another debate and another discussion.
Thank you very much, and I really say that there is an answer. I won't give it now to what the gentleman says, the member says, a comprehensive answer. I hope in this House to be able to discuss this at great length and say it. But I'll say this, when we're talking sort of about dangers and so forth, nobody in this House, the point has been made before, it's worth underlining, I doubt that there's a member of this Assembly who does not know somebody, either in their family or a neighbour or a friend, who has died from alcohol. I don't believe that there's a member here who doesn't know families which have been torn apart by alcohol. This is one of the distinctive features of alcohol in our society. And let me say that you turn on your television at night and you'll see adverts telling you that if you drink alcohol, you will have a wonderful time, you will be freed from your inhibitions and no harm will come to you. Who has ever seen an advert for Guinness which would end with the sight of young people lying on the pavement, being sicked into the gutter? Who would ever see that? And yet that is not untypical as a result sort of overindulgence in alcohol. I believe in, I'm a liberal, I believe sort of in as few restrictions on our behaviour as possible. I support this bill, I would go further as I say. But I think that we are discussing it in an extremely narrow way, that it has to be seen in the context of all sorts of other forms, sort of human behaviour and of the use of mind-altering substances, which is what we're talking about. They're all bad for you, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker. And it's a fact that in all these substances which have been mentioned here, and particularly alcohol, the younger you are when you start, the more damage it's going to do you on a permanent basis. And there's a simple reason for that, that when you're the mind of a child, the brain of a child, and an adolescent is not yet fully formed, is going to be more damaged by alcohol or any other such drug than it would be if you began when you were 20 or 25, or at a much later age. So we have to take all that into account. I'm in favour of liberalising the laws, but I'm all... Okay, go ahead.
Thank you. I thank the member for giving way. Very briefly, he says that the younger you start, the more damage it does. Does he agree with me then that that's a solid argument against the continental approach to alcohol, where young people are exposed to it from a very early age?
I think it's an argument for looking at this thing seriously, and it's an argument for saying that what we need here is not restrictions on when you can drink at any age. What we need is education, and we need people to understand the dangers of it and not to take it casually. And all of our society, over and over again, if you walk around the streets and billboards and television screens and the rest of it, you are urged to drink alcohol. After all, why do companies like Diageo, sort of Mick Guinness, why do they spend millions of pounds making very well made, artistically very impressive adverts to put on television to make people, to invite people to drink and drink more? That happens all the time, and there's no real debate. Now, I'm not suggesting again, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker, that we put restrictions on advertisement, sort of in television or anywhere else. What I am saying is that there are huge dangers here which can only be addressed really sort of by education, and education in every sense for people at a very young age about the dangers of alcohol. And when we are doing that, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker, and without transgressing on the rulings that you have made, I think we should also include sort of information and education about what other drugs will do, and point out that among the drugs which are freely available in our society, alcohol is the most dangerous, but some of the drugs which are illegal are much less dangerous. What sense can this make? Where's the rationality in this situation?
Minister.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and can I thank the members who took part in the debate. Can I thank them for the contribution that they made? There's no doubt that I think the committee stage for this is going to be a very interesting session. Obviously, the members of that committee will explore a range of the issues that were discussed. I did outline in my opening statement the broad principles of the bill. I know that members got into some specific detail around that, but obviously the committee will now go into the detailed evidence gathering for that and bring forward, I've no doubt, issues that we will seek to try and find an accommodation on. Let me give an undertaking to the committee that my officials will be available. We will proactively engage with the committee where we can find common ground on issues that members have touched upon that weren't consulted upon on this bill. Then that is something that I will want to work towards. Where we can't find common ground, well, then that obviously will be a matter that will come for consideration stage, and we'll have to take positions in respect of some amendments that will come forward in respect of these issues. I think people's contributions were in the round well informed, but I think it is always important that we recognise that whenever we're dealing with the issue about the consumption of alcohol, that this is a substance which I think the member for Foyle, Eamon McCann, said was mind-altering. And therefore, it's important that we have that foremost in our thinking. And I know members in the parties did indicate that, on the one hand, we need to tackle alcohol abuse. And I very much want to tackle the misuse of alcohol in our society. But where we can support the hospitality industry, where you have a much more regulated framework, well, then that is something that obviously this bill will do, and members may well have other suggestions as to how they believe that that can be added to, and that's something that I'll be open to for consideration. So, picking up just on some things that members did say in respect of the debate, I know Ms. Gildernew, who spoke first of all, talked around some of these issues, but did use language about making sure that this bill represents an outward and progressive Northern Ireland, that we need to use this bill as a vision for Northern Ireland. I think Claire Hanna indicated that Northern Ireland needed to come into the 21st century. And I suppose I would just, in those kind of comments, make the point to people that one person's version of what is progressive, modern, may not be the same for other people's, in terms of their interpretation as to what represents a modern and progressive society. And therefore, I think, let me pick up on what Ms. Gildernew did say. Let's have a mature and informed discussion about all of these issues and take evidence-based decisions in respect of it. I think it's easy to fly the flag of continental Europe, which I know my colleague Mr. Stalford touched upon, and people will say, well, they do it there, why can't we do it here? Well, I know whenever I've been in continental Europe, the experience that I've had whenever shops shut down during the middle of the day and they're not open, and then I come here to Northern Ireland and I find the shops are open more frequently than they are in other parts of continental Europe, tells me that there is different approaches need to be taken within different societies, not just within the United Kingdom, but right across Europe. And we need to have legislation based on the particular needs of our community. And so this is something that we need to address in terms of our own culture in Northern Ireland whenever it comes to drinking, because rightfully, all members who made comments on this identified there is a specific culture where binge drinking is prevalent. And that is something that needs to be tackled. Now, some people will have a different approach as to what the best way to tackle it is, but we certainly have distinct issues in Northern Ireland when it comes to alcohol misuse. And let me crystallise exactly the financial cost right across government when it comes to alcohol misuse. Every year it's costing £900 million. £900 million in terms of the consequences of alcohol misuse. And that was a report compiled by the Department of Justice whenever we were looking at the impact of alcohol misuse. 20% of all crimes in Northern Ireland is as a result of people suffering the consequences of intoxication of liquor. 45% of all crimes that relate to violence against persons is a direct result of individuals who are intoxicated by liquor. 1 in 6 admissions to accident and emergency is a result of alcohol misuse. That increases to 80% at peak times in our accident and emergency at weekends. So I think we need to be careful that people don't take a blasé attitude to alcohol and frame it in an attitude that I find at times can be somewhat dismissive as to the real consequences that there is when it comes to alcohol misuse. 12,000 admissions approximately each year to acute hospitals as a result of alcohol misuse. There are 4,000 people in Northern Ireland who are being treated for alcohol misuse. And when we get down to the impact it can have on younger people, 38% of 11 to 16-year-olds have consumed alcohol. And so whenever we look at some of the dire consequences, and Mr. McCann painted a very bleak picture, and rightfully so, in terms of people lying on the streets vomiting and the advertisements that take place, all always glamorising the consumption of alcohol, never showing what it's like to live in a home where the mum or dad has got an alcohol problem and how the children can be living in a difficult environment in respect to that, never taking you to the scene in the hospital bed where people are having organ failure as a result of a lifetime of alcohol abuse. You'll never see that when it comes to advertising. So how do we address that? And I accept that the vast majority of alcohol is now consumed in people's homes. Around 70% of all alcohol bought in off-licences, supermarkets, taken home and consumed, often in social isolation. And so there's where the primary cause of concern is. And if people are going to drink, I would much rather people are going to drink in a regulated framework where it is an offence for publicans and in licensed premises to serve people who are drunk. Now, it's not an offence at home to continue to drink and drink and drink, but it is an offence. How hard it is pursued, that maybe is something the committee might want to look at. But if you are serving someone who is already intoxicated by alcohol in a licensed premise, you'll be fined £2,500. So there you have a more regulated framework where I believe that there is at least some social responsibility being exercised upon individuals who want to engage in drinking alcohol. But I think it is wrong for people then to say that means the licensed premises, the regulated framework, shouldn't be subject to regulation. And here's where I part company on some of what Mr. McCann's contribution was outlining, where he described himself as a liberal on this issue, that he would want to go much further. I didn't take an exact quote of what he said, but I noted here that you, Mr. McCann, sorry, through you, Deputy Speaker, indicated there should be no restrictions whatsoever. Now, I stand corrected if that's not an accurate quotation, but no restrictions whatsoever. That's not being a liberal. That's being absolutely lawless when it comes to what is a very important issue where people should be entirely free to do whatever they want. I think there is a much broader and more sensible approach that we need to take in balancing the needs of the industry, which rightfully the hospitality sector are going to pursue greater flexibility when it comes to this. I would say that we need to ensure that we take in that context the whole industry. I don't believe that it's beneficial if people are going to be drinking to 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning. What impact will that have in our economy when it comes to 8 o'clock in the morning and you're meant to be out at work? So I think they will pursue a very particular narrow remit in terms of the hospitality industry and the tourism sector, but we need to take a much broader look at this. And I'm not aware of people being attracted to come to Northern Ireland because somehow they're looking at Northern Ireland and saying, I'm not going to go on holiday there because there isn't enough opening hours when it comes to pubs. I'm not aware of that being a big issue as to people determining whether or not they're going to come on holiday in Northern Ireland. In fact, it would concern me if we wanted to make the pitch for tourism in Northern Ireland, come to this province and you will be able to consume as much alcohol as you want at whatever time and which you want. That would be something that I think we need to be careful. We have a tourism product here in Northern Ireland, which in my view is much better than being able to have unlimited opening hours, and therefore we need to strike the balance. I'll give away.
Thank the Minister for giving way. I don't think anyone was suggesting that it would bring more people to Northern Ireland simply because they would be able to drink more. The issue is that about 35% of what people spend when they are here is in the hospitality sector on food and drink. It could certainly enhance their spend while they're here.
Well, I'm all very much for trying to enhance the spend for people whenever they come here. What I would indicate that to members that we need to make sure that when it comes to spending of money, I would like to encourage people to be spending that on tourist attractions, on going to facilities, not marketing Northern Ireland on the basis of the availability of alcohol. I don't think that's the kind of vision that we want for Northern Ireland. I don't believe that that's the progressive vision that people would want for Northern Ireland, and I don't believe it would actually deal with some of the issues that are being raised. But I already outlined at the start there are some very beneficial aspects of this bill for the industry. Now, I accept they'll want to get a lot more, and that's their rightful place to make that argument. But we as legislators need to take the issue in the round, and we need to address what is a very important issue around alcohol consumption, particularly the misuse of it, and the way in which we deal with that. And in respect of, I'll give way in one moment. Ms Long did make a point, and other members talked about, should we be exposing to young people? I think specifically it was around demystifying alcohol to children, and almost moderation is the best practice. Well, in terms of how we deal with this, I would be wary about that type of approach, because you could apply that approach not just to the consumption of alcohol, you could apply that to a lot of things in life, that somehow by exposing children to something which I believe is absolutely harmful for them. And nobody here at any point did advocate that children should be encouraged to drink alcohol, in fact quite the opposite. But when you bear in mind the devastating consequences of the misuse of alcohol, I do think we need to be cautious about how you would introduce alcohol into the attitude and educational approach towards children. And that's something that we would need to be careful. I'll take personal responsibility for how I bring up my children, and I certainly won't be exposing them to an approach of moderation is okay when it comes to drinking alcohol. And I think there's a wider issue around parental responsibility, and when I look at what happened at the MTV Awards up in Londonderry, streams of teenagers piling out, intoxicated, in an event that had a licence. But where was the parental control? Where was the adult over 18, which is meant to accompany a child of that age? It didn't work. And if people look at that, then that should help inform the approach that we take to what is and a very important issue. I think Mr Chambers wanted me to give
way. Minister, for giving way. Minister, in terms of cigarette sales, you know, recently we've put doors on cigarette cabinets, we've introduced plain packaging, we've cut down the size of cigarette packets and so forth, because of the health implications to smokers and the strain on the health service. You've shared with us today some horrendous figures over the effect that alcohol has in terms of crime, in terms of the cost to the National Health Service. Would the Minister agree that there is a case for maybe considering some sort of limitation on display of alcohol and off licences? It can be, you can go into an off licence as a non-drinker and almost want to buy a bottle of alcohol because it's laid out so attractively and so colourful in off licences. Would the Minister think there is a case for bringing in some control as to how it is displayed on off-licences?
Well, I think this is going to be an issue that members will want to explore in more detail, because obviously there are proposals in the bill where I'm going to restrict in terms of legislation, subject to the will of the Assembly, the ability to advertise within 200 metres of premises, and we want to make sure that whenever supermarkets have their areas within their premises where they're zoned off for selling of alcohol, that you're not even able to advertise outside of that area as well. So that'll be something where I suspect members will feel that we should go even further in tightening. And again, that's something that I would encourage the committee to consider. What areas do we need to go further on in respect of making sure we tighten it up as far as possible? Members touched on the issue of Easter, and I think Mr Agnew commented here about freedom of religion, freedom from religion. What I would say to members, Northern Ireland does rightfully, in my view, recognise Easter, both within the Protestant and the Catholic community, as a time of significance in terms of religious belief. Without the basis of Easter, which is grounded upon religious belief, there wouldn't be a public holiday. Now, you can't on the one hand argue we want to avail of the rights of having a public holiday which is given to you on the basis of religious belief, but then not expect that in some way there should be respect given to that particular holiday period. So I think it's something we should bear in mind. There has been some proposal around the Thursday in terms of going into Good Friday. But again, in the Irish Republic, the law on Good Friday prohibits the opening at all of any licensed premise pub in the south. It can't open full stop on Good Friday. And in Northern Ireland, obviously, on Good Friday, you are able to open. So yes, the opening hours during the Easter period are what are not what they normally are throughout the rest of the year, but Easter is not what it is throughout the rest of the year in terms of the religious significance of it. So I do think that we need to be mindful of that and take the balanced approach that we are taking to it. But without Mr Deputy Speaker going into any more detail, this is obviously going to be something that the committee will engage on. I think there are grounds where we can find commonality, but I have no doubt and have every confidence in the committee that it will explore this in great detail, and when we come back to consideration stage, there will be amendments that will need to be properly considered, and this House ultimately now is responsible for this legislation. It will be passed by the will of the Assembly, but we do need to come to it, in my view, on the basis of having a mature and informed discussion, and if we do that, well then I believe we'll reach a satisfactory outcome at the end of the process. So I beg to move this stage of the bill, Mr Deputy Speaker.
That the second stage of the Licensing and Registration of Clubs Amendment Bill be agreed. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. Contrary, no. No. Okay, I think the ayes have it. The Speaker, now I say that that concludes the second stage of the Licensing and Registration of Clubs Amendment Bill. The next item on the order paper is a motion on the draft BBC Charter and Framework Agreement. The Business Committee has agreed to allow up to 1 hour and 30 minutes for this debate. The Minister will have 10 minutes to propose and 10 minutes to wane. All other speakers will have 5 minutes each. Clerk, please read the motion.
That this Assembly takes note of the content of the draft BBC Charter and Framework Agreement.
Mr Paul Given to move the motion.
Mr Deputy Speaker, I beg to move that this Assembly takes note of the content of the draft BBC Charter and Framework Agreement. As Minister with responsibility for broadcasting matters in Northern Ireland, I am pleased to be here today to debate the draft BBC Charter and Framework Agreement. BBC Charter renewal is a very important issue for the broadcasting sector in Northern Ireland. People here attach a great value to having a comprehensive public service broadcasting service which reflects all aspects of our social, cultural and political life. The Royal Charter is the constitutional basis for the BBC. It sets out its public purposes, guarantees its independence, and outlines the various duties placed upon it. The current charter outlines the duties of the BBC Trust and the Executive Board. The proposed new charter will come into effect on the 1st of January 2017. The BBC's framework agreement is an agreement between the UK Government and the BBC, and it sits alongside the Charter. It provides detail on many of the issues outlined in the Charter and also covers the BBC's funding and regulatory duties. The BBC Charter renewal is a very important issue for our broadcasting sector, and it is essential that the needs of Northern Ireland are catered for in the new Charter and Framework Agreement. I want to see opportunities in the TV and film industry being maximised for local workers and companies, and it is essential that we receive fair treatment in regard to public service broadcasting spend on commissioning, particularly in relation to spending on Irish language and Ulster Scots broadcasting. The BBC should meet its obligations within the Charter to provide services for all of its communities, including Indigenous language broadcasting. It is also important that the portrayal of Northern Ireland on the networks shows a fuller picture of us as a modern society. It is also essential, and increasingly so, that the role diverse groups play within our society is reflected, and that people are not portrayed by a single aspect of their identity, such as ethnicity or disability. The creative industries are important to our economy, and the BBC is a major player in the creative industries ecosystem. As a result, it is essential that we have strengthened links and meaningful collaboration between the BBC and the wider creative industries. These essential changes, some of which that I've touched on earlier, include the following. There needs to be a full, authentic and accurate and more up-to-date portrayal of Northern Ireland on the networks, which show the fuller picture of our society. We've been underserved by public service broadcasting spend up to now, and we need, therefore, to see an increase and improvement in the commissioning of original programming showcasing our local communities. There also needs to be a more local cultural TV and radio coverage, and opportunities for local workers and companies must be maximised. There needs to be greater emphasis placed on homegrown productions and the harnessing of local talent. There must be increased commissioning of original programming showcasing our local communities and what they have to offer. It is crucial that the BBC has governance, management and funding structures which reflect the needs of each devolved administration and region and better support the development, production and delivery of content from us. Content that is available not just to our own audiences but also to wider audiences both within the United Kingdom and internationally. There should be a simple and transparent BBC strategy for Northern Ireland that is not only available for scrutiny by those responsible for governance but is also but is available as a roadmap and an empowering authority for the executives in the BBC and BBC NI. It is also essential that the Assembly has some means of holding the UK Government and the BBC to account to ensure that they provide for a truly representative service that is fit for purpose in the 21st century. Our Memorandum of Understanding gives in the Assembly a formal scrutiny role in regard to the BBC. Also, it provides for BBC officials appearing before Northern Ireland Assembly committees on matters relating to Northern Ireland on the same basis as it does in Westminster. These arrangements will be enshrined in the new Charter. This should provide a mechanism that makes the public service broadcaster accountable and answerable to this Assembly. Accountability should help ensure that we receive the economic and cultural value that we deserve and warrant from the BBC. In the past, there was a failure to ensure that Northern Ireland received the cultural and economic value from BBC network production that our population and devolved status demands. We need to be certain that won't happen again in the future. And the proposal set out in the draft charter will go a long way towards ensuring that it won't. Provisions that are of particular interest to Northern Ireland include the following. Specific provision is made for the nations in the new licensing regime. In addition, the new charter commits the BBC to continued support for the minority languages of the United Kingdom. In respect of accountability and governance, the BBC must reflect the constitutional arrangements within the United Kingdom. All of the devolved administrations will be able to agree to the appointment to the new BBC board for their respective member before they are appointed. The BBC has committed to improving representation and portrayal of the nations and regions of the United Kingdom through its services. The nation's and region's public purpose will emphasise the need for the BBC to support the creative economies of each of the nations of the United Kingdom through the delivery of its mission and public purposes. The BBC must now report against the creative remits set out in the annual plan on a nation-by-nation basis. The UK Government has recognised that the BBC's impact and contribution to the creative economy, particularly in the nations, is an important one, and I welcome that recognition. In conclusion, at this stage, let me say, Mr Deputy Speaker, that the BBC Charter Review has given us in Northern Ireland a formal role in contributing fully to the review process. The current drafts mirror many of the demands of the devolved administrations, and my officials and I will continue to engage with DCMS over the next number of weeks as we seek to ensure that our interests are clearly reflected in the final documents. Thank you.
Éirim Saoire, Lás Cathaoirleach, Den Coiste, Michelle Gildon, I call the Deputy Chair of the Committee, please. Michelle Gildon.
Ramin Maugov, Lás Cathaoirleach, Corla. The Committee received and noted copies of both the draft charter and the draft agreement that the House has been asked to take note of today. And the Committee has been offered a briefing by the current BBC Trust member and will decide at our meeting on Thursday whether that is required on the foot of today's debate. The future of the BBC has been much debated by the media over recent months, but I suspect that much of the detail of the debate has also only been of real concern to those in the media as well. It did seem to be the case at certain points in the Charter discussions a question of whether the BBC would survive at all as a public broadcaster, given what appeared to be ideological opposition to public sector broadcasting by the previous two Conservative Culture Secretaries, Saeed Javid and John Whittingdale. That argument has been settled, at least for the next 11 years, given that the Charter lasts until 2027. However, I might respectfully suggest that the details of the Charter and draft agreement are of little relevance to or interest to the ordinary person in the street. Of course, there are issues which do generate interest, such as the requirement to name people in the organisation who earn over 150,000, including the people who think of themselves as big stars. But in the overall scheme of things, that's not really that important. What is or should be important to us all in general is that we have the confidence that the BBC here is well governed and managed, that the licence fee is value for money, and that the BBC maintains its independence from government. I think it is broadly accepted that the new arrangements go some way to embedding processes within the structures of the BBC that seek to achieve these objectives. As mentioned, a key issue for the BBC throughout the Charter discussions was certainty over funding. The renewal of the Charter is for a further 11 years and should provide stability for the organisation in terms of funding. So arguments of the continuance of the licence fee have been put to bed, and the BBC should be able to get on with its mandate of providing broadcasting to the public that will educate, inform and entertain. It's also important to note the change in governance arrangements with the establishment of a new board rather than the current system where we have trustees. The role of this board will be extensive, but it's important to highlight the requirement for transparency in the workings of the board and the independence from government of each member. To that extent, it's to be noted that the government is to directly appoint 5 of the 14-strong board, including a new chair, and the 4 national directors for the North of Ireland, England, Scotland and Wales. This leaves the BBC able to appoint 4 executive members of the board alongside another 5 independent members, and this should provide some assurance that the board is independent. The change to the regulation of the BBC is a fundamental one. Currently, the BBC self-regulates, but from next year, Ofcom will take on that responsibility and it will have extensive powers. Of course, particular interest are the powers of Ofcom to determine whether the BBC's commercial activities, given their link to public services, do not give an unfair competitive advantage to the BBC. An operating framework will be produced in which Ofcom will set requirements that will define what the relationship between the BBC and its commercial activity should be. And this will be crucially important given that the powers of Ofcom in relation to the BBC are extensive, including the power to order it to cease activity it judges to be anti-competitive. I think in principle most of us would support the idea of external independent regulation, but it will be important to see to what extent these new arrangements restrict the BBC's commercial activity. This will be important in the context of Section 13 of the Charter, which seeks to promote and establish creative partnerships with other organisations where they would be in the public interest. We've seen the growth of the creative industries here over a number of years, and according to the Department, 36,000 people, or 4.6% of the workforce, are employed in the creative industries or in creative occupations. We don't want to see the potential of the BBC to assist with that burgeoning industry curtailed by regulation. In addition, the National Audit Office will report on the group accounts. The Secretary of State must then lay the group accounts and the report of the Controller and Auditor General before Parliament, and these must be subsequently published by the BBC. Similarly, they have to be laid before our Assembly on the same day as, or as soon as possible after, it has been laid before Parliament in Westminster. This should afford transparency on the expenditure activities of the organisation. And then turning to the local as well as to the big ticket programmes.
Would the member draw remarks to a close, please?
The approved popular local programming is also important to people, whether that's stories about our communities, local sports programming, or locally produced series with wider appeals, such as The Fall. The committee have got the offer.
Time is up.
Okay, Gormila Malcolm. Thank you.
Okay, I call Jonathan Bale.
I think, Deputy Speaker, that it's an important debate because I understand that while it's down as a take note debate, that the UK Government will look at what comes from the Northern Ireland Assembly and from Scotland and Wales, and that will then be factored in to the report which the UK Government will present the Charter and the agreement to the Privy Council in time for it to come into force on the 1st of January 2017. So the points we can make today, albeit within 5 minutes, should be the points that we want carried through. And indeed, the BBC has come a long way from the British Broadcasting Company as it was in 1922. Now, I think it was I'll probably not get the pronunciation correct, the Earl of Crawford and Ballycarr, who chaired the committee that led in 1926, looked at the United States and said, we don't want to see the sort of unregulated broadcasting, and produced a report which was accepted and I think has been a very good thing. And then the BBC became the British Broadcasting Corporation, deriving its authority from Royal Charter. So we have now an opportunity to present the points that Northern Ireland wants to see within the report. And I do note with a lot of alarm that the BBC has developed production centres in England, in Glasgow and in Cardiff, but none in Northern Ireland. I congratulate the former DECAL committee for the work that they did in terms of their legacy report on this, because it isn't acceptable that you have production centres in England, in Cardiff and in Glasgow, but you don't have it in Northern Ireland. And I think if we did have a BBC production centre in Northern Ireland, it would give our licence fee payers a proper return for the investment that they have put in to the BBC. There's a lot we want to see the independence, we want to see the transparency. I know Gregory Campbell, MP, formerly of this parish, will be delighted, particularly with one journalist, I suspect, if they have to declare anything over £150,000 in earnings. But I think it's really important for Northern Ireland that we take a strategic approach to supporting what are the creative industries here. We have seen so much over the years, not just with the BBC, but others, from Line of Duty right through to other productions outside the BBC in terms of Game of Thrones, where you've had some excellent productions, millions of pounds brought into the economy as a result of the creative industries. Now, what would it be like if, and the demand we should place here through to the UK government is we want a production centre in Northern Ireland to allow us to take a strategic approach and, as I say, give the licence fee payers some sort of return for their money. I do like the fact that the BBC is going to be put on a proper financial footing that should enable them to plan properly for the future. I also like the changes that will take it in terms of outside political cycles, because I do believe there is a role for the BBC to be independent into the future. Can I say one particular thing? I don't know whether it's myself having a midlife crisis or just whatever age I'm getting to. I'm listening to more radio than I am on podcasts than I am of television. And I understand that Northern Ireland its listenership to BBC Radio is much higher than any other part of the United Kingdom. So there is a strong argument for radio services to be more appreciated by the BBC, given that that is there. And there is some excellent radio from BBC Four, podcasts that I enjoy, written conspiracy thrillers from Matthew Brightendown. Wonderful, creative radio and news. And I think we should recognise, particularly in Northern Ireland, where we have an ageing demographic, that a lot of older people look to their radios as a form of company. It's their choice of what they're listening to in media. And given that there's that higher listenership in Northern Ireland to radio, I think we should have that increased investment in radio. So both radio, but for me critically, a proper production centre in Northern Ireland from the BBC to let us. We've already shown that we can outperform in the creative industries. I think it would be an asset for the BBC, it would be an asset for us, and it would be an asset back to the licence payer.
I call Andy Allen.
Opening, if I may, on behalf of the Ulster Unionist Party, pay our condolences to the renowned BBC NI broadcaster and journalist Paddy O'Flaherty. Our sympathies are with his family at this time. Mr. Deputy Speaker, the BBC Charter review is both timely and necessary. The BBC itself, a national institution which contributes greatly to the cultural life of the United Kingdom, and on the whole, it enjoys a great deal of public support. In return for the licence fee, the audience rightly expects the BBC to continue to produce high-quality, creative and innovative content. In my party's response to the BBC Charter review, we recognised this was and is a time of change for the UK, not least in terms of how devolution is impacting on Scotland, Wales and Northern Ireland. The BBC needs to adapt to these changes and ensure at the same time the interests of the nations and regions have a voice. One of the most important changes which the news and current affairs departments in BBC Northern Ireland has to adapt to is to recognise the existence of an official opposition at Stormont and to balance its reporting accordingly. In fairness, the BBC does not have an easy job, given that it has to try to cater for an extremely wide range of age groups, ethnicities and communities, including, of course, those in the devolved nations and the UK regions, where audiences need and expectations can and often do vary widely. Quite correctly, all feel that they have a stake in the BBC and all should be reflected in what the BBC does. We are well aware of the debate over how well the BBC service licence pairs in the devolved regions. Regional opt-outs ensure local news and programming fit within the BBC nationally, and it is extremely important that the people of Northern Ireland have access to a respected national broadcaster. We note that in Schedule 2, Paragraph 6, Ofcom have a great deal of discretion. It states that Ofcom must impose on the BBC the requirements they consider appropriate, having regard to the needs of the nations and regions. Many of the following clauses begin with the phrases, "What appears to Ofcom are such provisions as Ofcom consider appropriate." This theme is continued in Schedule 2, Paragraph 7, Programme Making in the Nations and Regions. Here it states the Ofcom must impose on the BBC the requirements they consider appropriate for securing what appears to Ofcom to be a suitable proportion of all the network programmes made in the UK, or programmes made in Scotland, Wales and Northern Ireland. Again, the phrase "what appears to Ofcom" keeps cropping up, and the role of Ofcom is one which is obviously key in ensuring the nations and regions receive fair and equitable treatment. The Ulster Unionist Party greatly value the importance of locally produced and commissioned programming, but it must be high quality. There is no doubt that the creative industries have been a real Northern Ireland success story in recent times, and the BBC has a major role to play in commissioning programmes and working with external producers in making programmes. This is an area where we feel the BBC can make a real positive impact on Northern Ireland PLC and help the local economy in the process. I will now return to the issue of BBC funding. The BBC faces challenges that were unforeseen even 20 years ago. The success and popularity of Sky TV and the growth of digital media platforms have provided a very different operating environment to the days when the only competition came from ITV and independent radio. It is crucial that BBC have a stable funding framework in order to enable forward planning. The 2006 Charter will extend for a further 10 years until the end of 2027, and the 2006 agreement will be revoked and replaced by a new framework agreement. This is a time frame which should provide sufficient security and stability for the BBC going forward. The Ulster Unionist Party recognises the key role which the BBC plays at both UK-wide and local level. We want to see a BBC that is fit for purpose and which meets the needs of the people of Northern Ireland and the United Kingdom as we progress into the 21st century. Thank you, Deputy Speaker.
Éireann Sir Nicola Mallon. I call Nicola Mallon.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Certainly, I fervently believe in the importance of having a reliant public broadcaster that acts in the public interest, serving all audiences through the provision of impartial, high quality and distinctive output, and services which inform, educate and entertain. You'll find no disagreement here, Mr. Deputy Speaker, in this objective of the BBC's mission in its Royal Charter. But the real test is in how these objectives are put into practice. I don't intend to go through the Charter comprehensively. I know other members will point out issues of importance to them, but there are just a few things that I would like to touch upon. The SDLP certainly welcomes the out-of-London quotas. But, Mr. Deputy Speaker, that must extend beyond the outer suburbs of London. It must reflect the cultural,
right,
social...
I'm picking up a number of conversations around the place. Perhaps members could, if they wish to conduct conversation, conduct them elsewhere, or less audibly at least. Thank you. Please continue.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Yes, but we are very clear that the out-of-London quotas must extend beyond the... Outer Hebrides and include the distinctiveness, the social, the cultural distinctiveness of Northern Ireland. And within that, Mr. Deputy Speaker, if you look at Derry and Belfast, for example, within the north, there are clear cultural and social distinctions there which must be protected and reflected through local services, like Radio Foyle, for example. The SDLP also welcomes the extension to this Assembly of parity with Scotland and Wales in relation to the appointments of nation members to the new unitary board. This is an accountability step that has certainly been long overdue. A number of members have also touched on the issue of salaries. Yes, of course.
To the member for giving way. Member be aware this is an issue that I raised in the Communities Committee about public appointments. There is, I suspect, in Northern Ireland a coterie of about 100 people who absolutely dominate all public appointments. Does she agree with me that it's essential that if the BBC is going to be truly a national broadcaster, it has to be reflective of the public, and that includes not just the sort of usual definitions that are used, but also issues like social class?
I thank the member for his intervention. I firmly believe that all appointments should be done in an open and transparent manner, whether that's for a spin doctor or whether it's for appointments to the new unitary board. So, in terms of salaries, yes, a number of members have passed comment, and I think that it's only right, and we welcome the move to greater openness and transparency in terms of the salaries of the BBC's highest earners. The public have a right to know how public money is spent, and I believe that it is as simple as that. What we would do, Mr. Deputy Speaker, is just to air a note of caution. The SDLP would be strongly against any suggestion of a move to introduce subscription charges for the BBC, because we do not want to see a first and second class system where people can only access their public service broadcaster based on their ability to pay. But we do welcome, however, the move to open up the tendering process. We think this is a positive move if approached correctly. Certainly, it improves the opportunities for us here in Northern Ireland to build on its success in producing world-class TV productions, not least the Game of Thrones. And finally, Mr. Deputy Speaker, my party colleague in Westminster, Margaret Ritchie MP, has already sought assurances from the Secretary of State that the collaboration between the BBC and RTE, which is a much valued one, will not be undermined. And I think it's very important that I take this opportunity to reiterate that point. Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker.
I call Naomi Long.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and I welcome the opportunity to speak on behalf of Alliance about the BBC Charter and Framework Agreement announced in Parliament on the 16th of September. The Charter is an essential instrument for an organisation which has become a cornerstone of broadcasting in the UK and also throughout the rest of the world. It is uniquely well respected as an institution, and whilst it is not without flaws, I believe it has an important role to fulfil as a public broadcaster. I want to focus my comments on three aspects of the draft charter and the particular opportunities and challenges they present to the BBC and Northern Ireland. Firstly, I'm concerned, unlike some others, that with this particular charter review we are witnessing further erosion of the BBC, but by means of stealth. The current government appears to want the BBC to be both public service broadcaster and at the same time commercially competitive, and in doing so places challenges in its way on both fronts. As has well been documented in the media, the charter will lead to the publication of the salaries of presenters and talent on the BBC. The argument is strong that this accounts for public money being expended. However, it could lead to the release of information which would be considered commercially sensitive by its competitors and could make the poaching of household names from the BBC to other channels much simpler. Whilst that may not seem much of an issue, it disregards the investment in talent and development which the BBC makes and the negative impact that it could have on viewing figures and popularity of its shows, for which the same people will no doubt also judge it very harshly in terms of performance. It seems the government lives up to the adage of knowing the price of everything and the value of nothing. The same pattern of commercialisation has led to the outsourcing of much BBC programming to independent production companies. Again, not of itself a bad thing. It results in programmes which only a public service broadcaster could afford to risk making, once they gain popular appeal, then being sold off to the highest bidder, again diminishing the BBC's schedule despite their investment in developing those programmes. A recent example of that is the Great British Bake Off. Who would have thought a show about competitive baking would grip the nation, but it has. However, it took a public service broadcaster to broadcast it on BBC Two before it was able to be mainstreamed onto primetime television on BBC One, and they have now lost out to a commercial operator. While some argue that that will allow new talent and opportunities to break through, it does also hit viewing figures on the BBC, which it is judged against for performance. Additionally, it's been announced the BBC will be funding free television licences for the over 75s in this charter. I welcome this move, and indeed I believe it could go much further. However, it will come at the expense of the BBC's running costs, its staff and programme content, rather than through any additional funding, further undermining its competitiveness. Mr Speaker, for both these reasons, I fear the intentions of the current government are perhaps not as honourable as they claim. My second concern is the independence of the BBC with inclusion of political appointees on the board. As a public service broadcaster, it must be seen to be independent, and it is hugely important that that is maintained. Political appointments have the potential to diminish that significantly. And given the various questions raised around public appointments in Northern Ireland, I am grateful that there will be a degree of transparency and openness around this, because it should not be politicised. The appointment of someone from Northern Ireland to the board does, however, represent opportunities to increase Northern Irish created content. Local content made in Northern Ireland for Northern Ireland is hugely important. However, if we're going to develop our creative industries, it's also important that the BBC commit to making national content in each of the constituent countries. Mr Speaker, we have demonstrated in Northern Ireland through television shows such as The Fall, Game of Thrones and the programme Lily's Driftwood Bay that Northern Ireland can create and produce world-class television. I want to see this built on through the BBC's local content commitment. Finally, Mr Deputy Speaker, an opportunity that has been lost is one to decriminalise the non-payment of a TV licence. It's one that my party leader, David Ford, raised with the Home Office during his time as Justice Minister and which could have been addressed in this charter. Just last year, a quarter of criminal prosecutions in Northern Ireland were for failure to pay the TV licence and less than half were found guilty. This puts significant pressure on the legal system, and decriminalisation would allow cost savings and non-payments to be pursued through non-criminal means. So accordingly, I note the BBC Charter Review and hope that the opportunities for improvement within the Charter are fully realised, whilst the risks to what is an excellent public service broadcaster and its independence are minimised. Thank you.
I call Christopher Stalford.
Thank you very much, Mr Deputy Speaker. Mr Deputy Speaker, the BBC is one of the great national institutions. It is extremely powerful. It's much more powerful, I would suggest, than any political party almost, certainly in Northern Ireland, and potentially in the United Kingdom as a whole. With such power comes a responsibility for regulation. And therefore, I welcome the fact that Ofcom are to assume regulatory powers in regard to the BBC. I think it's right that an organisation for which millions of people are taxed to pay for should be regulated in this way and should be scrutinised for the way in which it is run. I welcome the fact that there will be, as the member for East Belfast, Naomi Long, said, I welcome the fact that there will be a Northern Ireland representative appointed to make our voice heard. And given the comments from the former special adviser turned assembly member for North Belfast, I'm sure she'll be able to advise in terms of the public appointment procedures that she went through when it comes to appointing people. I am delighted that progress has been made by royal appointment. Progress has been made in terms of openness and transparency. The headlines have obviously been grabbed around the issue of talent pay and what they're being paid. But I think a more important issue is the importance that the coverage that's produced for Northern Ireland reflects Northern Ireland. And the BBC recognises this. It recognises that it has an obligation to minority languages and cultural expression. And I think one of the areas where I do believe there has been a falling away has been in terms of the representation of the entire Ulster Scots tradition. I am not an Ulster Scot in the sense of family background, but it's something that interests me and something that I've taken an interest in, because the shared heritage and tradition that there is, I mean, Northern Ireland and Scotland are literally divided by about 8 miles of water at some points and precious little else. And so it's part of who we are, it's part of our tradition, it's part of our identity, and I would like to see more reflection of that being produced by the BBC. I absolutely am not saying that, you know, the growth of one should be at the expense of another in terms of Irish language, because I recognise that that's important to people as well. But I think what we should have is a greater parity between those two traditions and how they're reflected. I think some of the programmes that have been produced have been really, really good, particularly I think of the programme about the Ulster Scots contribution in Canada, the series that was produced there. Yeah. And I would like to see more high-quality programming like that being produced for as part of the obligations that the BBC have in that regard. The BBC likes to talk about the unique way in which it is funded. That's code for the TV tax that we all pay. I agree, actually, with the point that's been made again by the member for East Belfast with regard to the need to decriminalise non-payment of a licence fee. It cannot be right that so much time and effort and resource is spent pursuing people, criminal charges against people, for the non-payment of a TV licence. Moving forward, I think more openness, more transparency as to how money is spent, a greater preparedness to reflect the society that it serves, and a genuine commitment to independence and neutrality. The BBC is, as I said, a great national institution. They cover events like the big national events, the Queen's Jubilee, the state opening of Parliament, even the general election coverage is better than that offered by anyone else. It's in all of our interests that it continues to be a success, but it's also in our interests that it's held accountable for the way in which taxpayer money and the way in which taxpayer money is spent. Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker.
Iram Sir Carol Nicholan. I call Carol Nicholan.
Thank you very much, Mr. Deputy Speaker. And I'd like to declare an interest at the start of this as one of the ministers, the other ones over there, who probably started the process around the charter and funding agreement around the BBC review. I mean, I'm personally delighted to see that some of the suggestions that were brought forward have been taken on board, but I still think, you know, notwithstanding the fact that our committee is going to meet on Thursday, that there's still some concerns around some of the issues. For example, I mean, the whole issue around the independence of the BBC, I think, is just a given. However, One of the things, particularly as a result of the Smith and Silk, or Silk and Smith Commission, and the funding arrangements, particularly around Scotland, and the memorandum of understanding that was brought forward then, it meant to say that ourselves here, and certainly Wales, felt that, you know, in that case, there was an inequality there. So that seems to have changed, and certainly the fact, one of the concerns I had about any body regulating itself, so Ofcom have now become the regulating body, and even the advisory committee and the arrangements around it have been listened to as well. I mean, you know, in 1 year, I think it was something along the figure of almost £4 billion that the BBC had accrued. And, you know, a lot of us would like to know how that money was spent. And one of the issues I had, listening to Jonathan Bell talking about the BBC needing to have almost a production house here, I would actually tend to disagree with him, because I think one of the arguments that we've made successfully is that we have excellent producers and commissioners and the ability to commission programmes here. And in order for our independent creative sector, creative industries to thrive, we need to try and support that. The BBC haven't exploited that skills and expertise that we have here as much as they should have, in my opinion. I also believe that without the broadcasting funds, the BBC within itself have not contributed enough to Ulster, Scots, and certainly to the Irish language. The broadcast funds, while they're administered through BBC and even through the work of the NI screen, still, for me, raises concerns. I'm still, you know, not convinced this argument around parity of those broadcast funds stands up, to be frank. I do share some of the concerns and have shared some of the concerns, and that will be reflected somewhat in the Charter, about making sure, and the Minister touched upon this in his opening remarks, that in terms of making sure that we are represented in a way that is true and reflective and faithful to people here is really, really important. And I believe the BBC have lacked in that in the past. And one of the best ways that we can change that is to spend more money here commissioning programmes. Indeed, we've made excellent programmes that can be shown anywhere. And I believe it's a two-way process. There hasn't been enough done, despite the fact that the creative industry sector here and NI Screen and indeed with the BBC here have went and lobbied and argued for that. And the context for all that argument was particularly around the Charter renewal and indeed the funding agreement. I don't think it's challenging the independence of the BBC to ask where the money's being spent and, more importantly, how it's being spent. I would definitely like to see more of a breakdown in terms of local commissioning here, and particularly more commissioning in addition to the broadcast funds around the Irish language and the Ulster Scots. I did share some of the concerns around some of the outworkings of some of those programmes, particularly in relation to the Ulster Scots. But again, I mean, that's by the by. That's something that we need to certainly look at. For us, I think it's really, really important that we need to look at governance and lessons learned around the failure around some of the governance issues of the BBC in the past. I mean, one of the biggest issues certainly would be the governance around some of the historical sexual abuse allegations. I think the BBC were disgraceful, quite disgraceful in the way that they governed. They looked after the celebrity rather than the victims. And I think, if anything, this presents us with an opportunity that should never happen again. Quite looking forward to hearing what some of the big presenters earn. I think we could maybe, you know, take a guess on that. So this is a take note debate. Yes, by Craignahan. I'm delighted to take part in this, delighted that we've got it thus far. But there's still much more work that we need to do.
I call Nelson McCausland.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. And the BBC, as the principal public service broadcaster for the United Kingdom, has a special place in the life of the nation. It has a role in representing Northern Ireland to the wider United Kingdom audience through its programming, and also, in the other direction, in representing the diversity and the unity of the United Kingdom to Northern Ireland viewers. It is, of course, the British Broadcasting Corporation. It's important also that it has a role as regards preventing the marginalisation of Northern Ireland and indeed the other nations and regions, and avoiding what has in some cases been identified there as a rather a London-centric approach, particularly in regard to commissioning, where I think Northern Ireland has not been adequately represented in terms of commissioning at a United Kingdom level. There's also the important issue as regards providing employment in Northern Ireland and supporting the cultural sector, whether that be in-house productions or the work of independent producers. And we want to see, I think, going forward, a better and greater focus on Northern Ireland, and especially in terms of equitable capital investment. Other regions of the United Kingdom got major capital investment. Northern Ireland was overlooked. And in that regard, could I say there are some excellent locations in the heart of Belfast, close to the University of Ulster and on the north side of the city centre. I'm glad I have the endorsement there of the other member, at least one of the other members of North Belfast. One of the issues that was touched on there, and it was touched on by several people, was in regards to reflecting cultural traditions and diversity within Northern Ireland. And there has to be a commitment there, because education and broadcasting, the school system and the broadcasting system, are hugely important in affirming, sustaining, and supporting local cultural traditions. That is why the Irish language lobby has made such an emphasis on Irish medium schools and in ensuring also that there is a substantial provision for the Irish language in terms of BBC broadcasting. So there is an important role there for broadcasting in affirming, sustaining and supporting cultural traditions. But it's important that that is done in a way that is fair and equitable. And Karen Bradley MP, the Secretary of State for Culture, Media and Sport, in a letter that was circulated, made particular reference to minority languages, in our case Irish language and also Scots language, and culture and cultural broadcasting. Because that is not simply an issue of the BBC, that is an equality issue for Northern Ireland, and it is also a human rights issue. Now, I noticed that the former DCAL minister has now left us. Commented on her view that there was not a strong case for parity between the two broadcasting funds. That simply doesn't stack up. Because if you look at the evidence, and I pressed her on this point once about how you would measure and how you would justify spend and measure need. And one of the things that she mentioned was viewing figures. Well, if you actually look at the viewing figures for programmes that are supported by the Irish Language Broadcast Fund, and then you look at viewing figures for programmes that are supported by the Ulster Scots Broadcast Fund. The viewing figures for the Ulster Scots Broadcast Fund and supported programmes, those viewing figures are actually in most cases higher than those for the Irish Language Broadcast Fund. The one exception I have to confess for the Irish Language Broadcast Fund is the programme where Daniel O'Donnell and his country music show goes to Newry. I'm sure that will draw strong support from Mr. Kennedy and folks in that particular area. But I suspect, and I could be wrong in this,
grateful to the member for giving way, and of course any mention of Newry is very worthwhile. And let me also say, it might be interesting to study the viewing figures of Stormont today for insomniacs and burglars.
Well, I haven't actually members seen the viewing figures for that, but could I suggest to the members today that the viewing figures, which are exceptional for Daniel O'Donnell and his country music show, are probably more a reflection of the fan base of Daniel O'Donnell than they are a measure of support and interest in the Irish language, but I leave that to others to work on. What I would say is that in Northern Ireland, the current approach by the BBC has been inequitable and unfair, with preferential treatment and provision for Irish culture, both as regards the BBC's own core budget, where there is an in-house, or there has been an in-house Irish language unit, something that was never replicated, both as regards its own core budget, and then the mention was made of the broadcast funds. There is a huge disparity between those two funds, and sadly, the previous culture minister did not fight the corner there for equity and parity. Now, her party has a message, they often put it up, a slogan, an Ireland or an island of equals. But when it came to the broadcasting funds, some were more equal than others. And certainly it was her cultural tradition that she was fighting for rather than any other. So in that regard, Mr. Deputy Speaker, I would emphasise going forward the need for the BBC with its own budget and the two broadcast funds to ensure that there is an opportunity there for fairness, equity and equality, and that cultural rights are delivered to us all. Thank you.
Okay, I call Eamon McCann.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. I think it's fair to say that there are no two British institutions more widely admired around the world than the BBC and the National Health Service. They have also got this in common, that both these institutions have been for some time and continue to be under relentless assault from people and interests who believe that the free market should be allowed to rip through every aspect of our lives. That aspect of what's happening to the BBC is represented in the Charter, and I regret the fact that it hasn't been mentioned by any speaker since so far. If you look at the Charter document, you will see that it refers to the necessity of the BBC in the future to be aware of what it calls the wider media market, the key word there being market. And the rest of the Charter, if you look through it and comb out the phrases, you will see what is intended. The direction of travel of the BBC, which the government in London and commercial interests, most ferociously the Murdoch Empire, where they want to force the BBC to go. In relation to scheduling, this is what the Charter says, that the BBC must take into account any potential adverse impact on fair and effective competition. What does that mean? It means that when deciding what to broadcast and when to broadcast it and on what channel to broadcast it, the BBC must take into account the effect that this might have on ITV or Sky or other providers. In other words, it's saying that the BBC must step into the commercial market, otherwise it will not be meeting, according to the Charter, meeting its legal responsibilities. I regard that as a very ominous aspect of this Charter. I think that there's very little in the Charter. Well, there's much that I would welcome in it, but I'm drawing attention to the things which concern me, which I believe ought to concern this House. There's very little in it which would safeguard the BBC's independence in funding or in governance. As Gilder News already mentioned, the fact that the government will appoint the new chair of the unitary board, a very powerful position, and that chair, a government appointee, will then appoint not four, as she said, but five other non-executive directors. This means that the government of the day will be in a powerful position to influence sort of how the BBC is run, what values it expresses, and all the rest of it. I think that's regrettable, and I think we all should express our regret about it. The government has shown no willingness to respect the BBC's independence. Let me give you one example from the recent past. The government decided that the BBC should fund free licences for the over 75s. What was the rationale for that? Why now did they do that? They spelt it out. They were quite open about it. It was part of welfare reform. That's what was said at Westminster. We'll hit the BBC for millions as part of welfare reform. That's an absolutely disgraceful way to treat an institution like the BBC. We in the North have a lot to thank the BBC for. I come from Derry, where Radio Foyle sort of has got phenomenal sort of listenership figures for the size of its area. It is tremendously important for the cultural life sort of Derry, just as Radio Ulster is for the whole of the North. I would say I've got a particular interest in popular culture and popular music. I would say sort of that the BBC in Derry, Stephen McCauley's Electric Mainline programme in Belfast, the Across the Line, sort of Stuart Bailey and people, there would not be the wonderful efflorescence of youthful talent in the area of popular culture had the BBC not given an audience to many of the young bands which are coming forward, when it made no commercial sense for them to do it. No commercial sense at all for Stephen McCauley to be playing the local music of bands. Yet some of them have gone on to great things, and even those which haven't gone on to great things have actually provided an uplift and a sort of an area of imagination to thousands of people which they otherwise would not have had. I'm not a starry-eyed, uncritical admirer of the BBC, not by any means, but I believe that it is a precious asset for our society, which should be defended, and it shouldn't be left simply to BBC employees, like the journalists organised in the NUJ, to defend its independence. Assemblies like this should step forward and defend the BBC, and I urge us all to do so, because it is under threat.
I call on the Minister for Communities, Mr Paul Given, to wind on the debate on the motion, and just to emphasise to the Minister, there's 10 minutes for this.
Okay, well, I'll not need the 10 minutes, Deputy Speaker, but thank you for the offer. Can I say it's been an interesting debate that we've had, and members have raised a number of important issues, and I've no doubt they'll be reflected upon as well by Westminster ultimately when this is being debated there, because it is a UK-wide issue. But we have had an opportunity this time, unlike before, to be able to feed into the process, to influence, and I think when you look at the Charter, you can see real tangible evidence of the value that that input has had, and I want to commend my officials who've been engaging on this issue with DCMS and with counterparts in Scotland and Wales. And we have been able to put forward a case, I believe, for the devolved regions within the United Kingdom, which is being reflected in the Charter and the Framework Agreement, and we will see tangible benefits flowing from that. A couple of comments picked up by some members I thought were noteworthy. I was impressed with Andy Allen's effort to indicate that the Charter and the Framework should have more of a focus on ensuring that the opposition gets better representation. Let me say I would be delighted to have ever more publication and coverage of how the opposition performs in Stormont to the masses. I think that that would do them probably no good at all, but I would be quite happy to put forward such an argument.
I'll give away. The Minister for giving way. The Minister will note that throughout the course of today's business it had to be presented to us not by the Leader of the Opposition, but actually a member of the Government, the Deputy Chair of the Committee. And the first so-called Opposition Day that we had in this House, the Leader of the Opposition, or Mike Nesbitt's Deputy, or whatever his official title is, couldn't be here yesterday either.
Thank the Member for that comment. I'll leave it hanging there. But obviously members have raised a number of points. Let me say that I do think that we are very well served here in Northern Ireland by the BBC in the round. I'll point out a couple of areas where I think that they could do a lot better in representing Northern Ireland more accurately. But in the round, it is an institution that should be defended. Mr McCann highlighted it in terms of two of the finest British institutions. The BBC is up there. And when we consider coverage of the radio programmes that were highlighted by Eamon McCann, I prefer Hugo Duncan over other programmes in the morning. I have to say, since I've taken up this post, I listen even less to the news outputs now on the BBC than ever before. But Hugo Duncan, I find, presents good value for money and is worth paying the licence fee for just for that slot. When you think of how local sport is covered, the coverage that you have of Ulster Rugby, you think of the coverage that you have of the Northwest 200, the Ulster Grand Prix, in terms of motorbikes. It's fantastic. And the audience that you get when that's being streamed as well, right across the globe. And so I think in our local sport, we are being very well served. But do I believe the BBC could do more? Yes, I do. In reflecting our culture, you take, for example, Scarva and the parade that takes place by the Royal Black Preceptory, right? And the tens of thousands of people that take part in a demonstration of our heritage, culture, and a demonstration of the arts. What coverage does the BBC give to that event? Very little, if at all. And I think that that is something that the BBC need to address. I think in its news output, and obviously it's independent in terms of editorial decisions, but the BBC is an incredibly pro-European organisation, which was reflected in its coverage throughout the referendum campaign. I think of its coverage of social issues across the United Kingdom, and again it pursues an incredibly left-wing liberal agenda. And when I look at when I look at even the commentators that dominate on the BBC, I struggle to listen to where the commentators, so-called, that are brought on as independent, that ever represent a more socially conservative point of view which prevails in Northern Ireland when I listen to its programme. So I think the BBC could do more to accurately reflect Northern Ireland. And this will be an opportunity now, because the Assembly will be able to hold to account the BBC and pull people in and ask them how are they representing Northern Ireland. And there are two areas where I think the BBC can do more. The BBC does, of course, have to represent the values of the United Kingdom right across the world, and those values of fairness are fundamentally important, and I think the BBC do that well. And whenever I look at the BBC in terms of its Royal Charter, I think that's to its credit that it was recognised in such a way. And it is unique in terms of the way in which its incorporation is found. And just as an aside, when I was reading the Royal Charter, I think the language that's used in that opening page for members that want to read it is an excellent demonstration of the English language. Elizabeth II, by the grace of God of the United Kingdom of Great Britain and Northern Ireland, and of our other realms and territories, Queen, head of the Commonwealth, defender of the faith. Yeah. And you go on and you read in terms of the language that is used. Whenever it got to highlighting the role of the minister at Westminster, this is a title that I would love to see an incorporation of a body in Northern Ireland where I could have this title. But it reads then, to us, by our right and trusty and well-beloved councillor, Karen Ann Bradley, our principal secretary of state for culture, media and sport. It's a fantastic demonstration of how the English language can be presented in such a fabulous way, and I would encourage members to read all of that. If time permitted, I would love to read it out into the record, but I think it's a tremendous recognition of the BBC as the British Broadcasting Corporation, something in Northern Ireland that the BBC should be very proud of. But obviously this is going to have a positive impact in terms of the content of the Charter. Northern Ireland, I believe, over the next 11 years will now get a more equitable deal from the BBC, and the BBC has set down in these documents that it accepts that it has a clear obligation to provide services for all of its audience and to represent and reflect its nations, regions and communities. In addition, going forward under the new arrangements, this Assembly will now have the ability to hold the BBC to account where it falls short on that delivery. So I commend the draft BBC Charter and Framework Agreement, Mr. Speaker, and ask the Assembly to support the motion.
Okay, the question now is that the motion standing on the order paper be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. I think the ayes have it. The ayes have it.